Happy Friday, everybody. Ben and Woods, 97.3, The Fan. We are here. We are live. We are together on a cold and wet and windy Friday, but we're in a nice, warm studio with nice, warm lighting and nice, warm sweatshirts and great show planned. It's a really, really nice Friday so far for the program. It's great to be here with you. I'm Woodsy. That's Paul Reindl. I'm going to take my gum out. He is the executive producer of this program, also the imaging director of the station. It makes a lot of images as well, a lot of graphics and whatnot. So he's a man of many talents, wears many hats here, literally and figuratively.
Not today, though.
Yeah, not today. No hat. Rocking the fresh
hatless
cut. How many hats would you say you own?
Probably 20.
Bo has you smoked by like 40.
I believe that.
My six-year-old has like... He has like a bevy of 60 hats to choose from on a day-to-day basis, dude. And he's way into it, man. We got Benjamin Higgins.
Yeah, we got about, I'd say 20 to 20
hats.
Yeah.
I do too. I wear one, like one to two now. Nothing looks good on me. And I'll ask Ben the same question. Benjamin Higgins is your friendly neighborhood sports anchor, also does sports on television on Channel 10. I feel like we don't mention that enough. I feel like we don't pull enough content from your news stuff. So if we could do better at that, that'd be great.
I had a fascinating piece running today. The 10 News Leadership Award will be
handed
out this evening.
Okay. Did I win?
You did not win this month. It's actually going to a really cool program. It has nothing to do with sports whatsoever, but it's a San Diego refugee tutoring program.
Okay.
So you got these families that are brand new to the United States. And very few of them speak any English. Mm-hmm. They're like political refugees. They're fleeing like wars and persecution. And they're here like legally as refugees, but they don't speak English. And then their kids come with them. And they may be like in sixth grade. So they put them in sixth grade, but they don't speak any English. They haven't had, you know, first through fifth grade. So they're way behind their classmates. And it's almost impossible to catch up. So this program has one-on-one tutoring with volunteers, like an army of volunteers that comes in. It's in City Heights. And they
work
twice a week after school trying to help these kids catch up with their language, reading, and writing skills. And this woman was a teacher at this elementary school. And she saw all these kids struggling. And 15 years ago, set up this program. It's gotten bigger, and it is it's pretty cool what they do. I was amazed when I went and shot it a couple of weeks ago, and it will air tonight on ABC 10 News at 5 p.m.
It'll air at 5?
Yes.
Okay, excellent, excellent. I was gonna talk about hats.
Oh, we can talk
and
about hats, too.
You went, and I was like, he's...
You brought up 10 News.
Refugee talk.
Refugee talk and tutoring talk. I was, okay, that's
so,
fine. No,
so
I mean, it's a really cool thing.
I have about four hats, and I... rotate
how
between
many non-golf hats
them. They are
the other question.
They're all golf hats pretty much.
How many did you spend your
none.
Own yeah right
none. Not my hats are all free. But I will say,
hold on, you have I know them. They have the Callaway AI smoke hat, the white one that
got
we just
my
got.
fire pit collective from Janela
that was given to us.
Yeah.
And then the landscape
landscaping is a big one that I enjoy.
What's the one? What's the name of the company? I don't want to shortchange. Because I like them a lot. It's your favorite hat.
I want to say it starts with a P. It just looks good on me, though.
It does.
They're not an official sponsor, but...
No. Do you find that the older you get, the worse you look in hats? Because that has been my
experience. I've never looked great in hats.
I used to look great in hats. Great.
In my defense, my wife, Shelley, has... like 70 hats, and she probably only likes to wear them once. She loves getting a new hat, wearing it once, and then getting a new hat after that.
That's wife behavior right there is what that is. That's what I call that
in
my house.
So we have tons of hats, and if I wanted to steal one or two of those, I always feel like I can, because once it's been worn once, unless it's like really her favorite, you rarely see it again a second time.
Yeah, that's wife behavior.
I mean, I do have various like seals slash
yeah, you do have a seals hat,
slash
yeah.
other giveaway hats that have just accumulated over
Padres
the years.
Hat.
Yeah, I do have a Padres hat.
Which one?
It's a tan one. It's kind of a.
It better not be this one.
It's not.
No.
The giveaway.
No, it's not a giveaway hat.
No.
It's a real Padres hat.
Somebody
gave
it to
you. I don't remember where
you.
I got it.
Somebody gave it to you.
It's It actually does look decent on me. It's a little different. It blends with other colors a little bit better. Sometimes Padres brown and gold can be tough to match with what you're just wearing on a regular day.
Very.
Looks great on the field, but tough to match in your...
They look good in it.
Yeah, they look great in it. It's tough to match with your regular everyday attire unless you're wearing Padres gear.
Every hat I own now, Paulie and Benny and you listening, every time I get a new hat and I put it on, I look like Alex Torres who wore the big Padres hat that they were going to try to institute. And I know that I shouldn't have made fun of it at the time. They were trying to do something good to protect players from getting hit in the head.
That's the style, though. I mean, your kids' hats are like twice as big as their heads.
But that's because they're little.
True.
And no hats fit. I'm not little.
No.
So I put a new hat on and I go, oh, I look like Alex Torres. And again, I'm a human being. When he took the mound wearing that hat, I couldn't help but laugh.
It was for safety, though.
I understand. I couldn't. Paulie just put it up in the chat.
It was for safety. He did look like one of the like the Super Mario Brothers mushroom
guys.
You stomp on,
so,
unfortunately.
Here's what I'm going to do for you guys and the Tier 1. When I go home today, if I remember, I can do this. And if I don't, remind me. I'm going to model 10 hats in my closet. Every single picture looks like that.
Oh, my God.
Everyone, Hannah goes, ooh, maybe not that one. And I'll grab another one out.
I think my head has shrunk.
I think my head has gotten.
Now, I got a haircut like 2 weeks ago now, almost 3 weeks ago probably. Sometimes that will make your hats fit a little bit differently, but I'm like a full size lower now.
Okay, the other thing, are hats worse now than they used to be? Everything is bulbous. Every hat's
very
big bulbous crown. And I had to go online once.
Like, are we all railroad engineers now?
Yeah, that's
what's
right.
What's going on?
So I go online, and I'm like, Google, how to not look like a dip-ass when you wear a new hat. And this guy has this full system. He gets in a hot shower. Mm. He wears the hat in the shower.
I think I've heard of this.
And he molds it to his head, and he soaks his hat.
Then, like, you dampen the inside.
He wears it in and just fully soaks it. Then he gets out, and he takes a hair dryer, and he dries the little weaving that's in, you know, that makes the big wall in the front, dries that with a hair dryer, melts it a little bit, then puts it on again, then form fits it. It takes about 6 weeks to get a hat ready that you bought, so you really have to plan ahead. I don't know how I got on this topic, but I think I just said Paulie wears a lot of hats, and we did 10 minutes on hats.
Hats out there?
You guys like hats? I went to yesterday. I couldn't make the round table. I did listen to the roundtable, and I thought you did a great job, as always, Benji. And I texted Adam and was like, okay, so with Ben, Annie, Elston, Tony, Chris, and Braden, I said, I'm sorry I missed it again. If I'm in the next one, are there enough mics?
No, we have a numbers problem here. We are one microphone short if everybody shows up.
Okay.
And I asked Adam the same thing.
Oh, did you?
And he said, well, Tony's going to be, you know, joining us remotely a lot of the time because he's going to be traveling with the Padres and or at the ballpark, depending on what kind of, you know, if it's a day game. So most of the time, you won't have all of us in studio concurrent.
So then we'll have the perfect number of mics.
Right. And there's another chair here. You could just sit next to Braden.
That's true.
If I'm running it, you could just sit here and use this mic.
I guess I could.
Braden,
it moves.
He doesn't chime in during the roundtable. There's enough voices already, so he doesn't need a microphone.
There are six microphones. There are six people.
Okay, six mics, six people. It sounded
seven people.
It sounded good. I thought you did a really good job, Benny. I thought everyone sounded good. I love listening to Tony Gwynn Jr. talk about hitting. It's really one of my favorite things to do.
I love everybody in the roundtable, but it is hard not to keep going to Tony just because I don't get the opportunity to talk to him that often, and I'm always curious and have some specific Tony questions about his time as a former player and how it relates to the Padres. But everyone had great opinions yesterday. I want to get your thoughts when we continue this morning on a couple of the topics that we got into on the roundtable yesterday as well.
I thought it was good. I listened about 30 minutes because I had to drive to get my stitches out yesterday. And I don't know when the last time you guys got stitches or got them out.
I've never had a stitch.
So I forgot how much that part of the thing sucks. When they
getting them out.
Yeah, when they stitched me, I was numbed, and they gave little shots. I was very numbed, and they cut this cyst out of my back, and it was great. And they stitched me up, and I remember feeling like the pull, but I didn't feel any pain. Yesterday, I sat down, you guys, and she goes, okay, take your shirt off. So I did, kind of leaned forward. She goes behind me, and you hear, she has little, you hear like, she
like clicks scissors.
It, like little, like the little
tiny
click, and then she pulls it out. And I went, She goes, yeah, boy, he really used thick stitches here. And I go, yeah, he did. And the next one, she pulls out.
Sailor's rope.
Yes. The next one, she pulls out. I go, ah. She goes, ooh, I pulled out a hair, a whole hair. And I'm like, God, son of a.
It's a back waxing.
It was like she pulled the stitch along with a hair by the root out of my back, Betty. I was like, oh, God, son of a. She's like, oh, don't worry. Just five more. I was like, oh, God, oh, God. It was horrible. I texted Hannah.
What happened to dissolvable stitches? Wasn't that a thing at some point?
So it's funny you mentioned that. So I get these things out. She goes, oh, a little blood here. So she cleans it up, puts the little patch on my back. She's like, you're fine. Looks great. I'm like, oh, thank God. I told Hannah, I go, all right, I know you wanted me to get this thing cut off. I said, the next time, the juice ain't worth the squeeze, literally in this case. It's not worth the squeeze of being with stitches for 2 weeks. Like, don't lift weights, don't throw, don't golf. I'm not doing it. You're going to have to live with a husband that has a...
I'm not going to, so quit asking.
Small humps.
Some humps on his back. And if you don't like it, I don't know what to tell you. Okay? Like, just don't rub your hands up and down my back.
Baby got a stitch around.
Lisa says, this is why men don't birth children.
Yeah, I know. Oh, I get it. Yeah. I'm a giant wuss. I get it. It hurt like a mother.
Baby got a stitch around.
What's that from?
Boomerang.
Boomerang.
He goes, he's about to go on a date. And he goes, you remember that girl I met in emergency? Baby got her stitches out.
Baby got a stitch around.
Yeah, the baby did get his stitches out yesterday. So then I had to go to the dentist. And you got to look at the dental work he did. Now, those were dissolvable stitches. And so
remember that little girl I met in an emergency? Yeah. Baby got a stitch around.
The best. The greatest movie of the 90s. And it's not particularly close. And I bet you.
Not true.
I don't know
it's
about
the
that.
Greatest movie of the 90s. True. Have you seen it?
No.
It is the best movie of the 90s. By far. By far. Taught me everything I know about women. Every single thing I know about women I learned from Eddie Murphy, Martin Lawrence, in Boomerang. So that was my day yesterday, but I would have rather been at the round table. 1,000% would have been sucking down pizzas, drinking Pepsis, you know, listening to you guys and chopping it up with you about baseball. I would have rather done that. So we're not doing that anymore again in the Woods household. It was, you know, fairly expensive too for a cosmetic procedure, and it hurt like a mother, dude. So not doing it anymore.
We have a very busy Friday, so we got to get moving here. We'll come back, we'll set the menu, and we'll give out a pair of Clapton tickets. We saved two for Friday because today's the day that they go on sale. Paul, you giving me the side eye? Like, no, you just forgot to give one away yesterday. No. We did this on purpose.
Yeah.
We saved two for today to remind you that they're going on sale. So we'll give out one pair when we come back, along with setting the menu, and then tell you about all of our great guests on a Friday, including an in-studio celebrity. Was he in Boomerang?
He was not in Boomerang.
Don't think he was in Boomerang, but we got an in-studio celebrity coming up as well. All of that ahead with Ben and Woods on a Friday morning. Glad you made it to the end of the week. Ladies and gentlemen, the weekend. Kelly Danick with traffic coming up next here on 97.3 The Fan.
Baby got a stitch around.
Did everybody enjoy their Padres day off?
Yeah, very much.
It's always, actually, yeah.
Always nicer coming off a win.
But I was thinking about, when did the game end on... The last game was on Thursday.
Wednesday
afternoon.
4 o'clock.
4 o'clock. You just felt a little bit empty inside, you know, because it ended early. And then Padres off to San Francisco. And then no Padres baseball last night was tough, but we did the Dave and Buster's thing yesterday. We had an absolute blast.
Oh, that's right.
It was
rewarded Bo.
Yeah.
For having to sit around at the nail appointment and the dentist appointment. By taking it to Dave and Buster's.
I'm wrecked. He goes, I'm wrecked. He's the night before. He goes, I'm wrecked. I go, he goes, oh, I'm going to be wrecked.
Rough spring break?
Yeah, tough spring break, dog. And he's like, oh, God, mom's nail appointment, your appointment. I go, all right, we'll take you to Dave and Buster's.
Where could he possibly be modeling that that behavior from? I have no idea where he sees that.
I'm wrecked. I'm wrecked, he says. We had so much fun. They've changed their menu at Dave and Buster's for the worse, in my opinion. When you used to get mac and cheese at Dave and Buster's, Ben, they used to give you the Kraft mac and cheese. Like Kraft. It was Kraft mac and cheese. Now it's some soupy concoction. It's real cheesy. You used to get a trough of Kraft mac and cheese.
I think I know your mistake here.
Eating at
Dave and
Buster's.
Don't eat at Dave and Buster's. Go for the games.
Yeah, well, I get it. But it's there.
It's a valid point.
It is a valid point.
It's tough to argue.
It's somebody just said it's trash. It's not trash. It's just not. It's not what it was.
It's there. It's available because if you're there for a couple of hours and you get hungry,
it used to be gourmet.
It's not gourmet. It's better though. Chili's used to be. I had Chili's recently before a Seals game. They've changed the chicken crispers. They're different. And Dave and Buster's had the same. They all go to the same place, and so the quality of things is going down. Right now, and it's not making me happy. I'm not going to take my kids to Valentina, though, before we go to Dave and Buster's. Like, we're there.
Spiro's, maybe?
Yeah, Spiro. Let's get some...
Buona Forchetta.
Yeah. I mean...
Take them somewhere nice.
I just expect
Why not?
More.
Take them somewhere nice before you go to play games and skee ball. I don't want to be handling skee balls and then going to grab some chicken fingers at the same time.
Yeah, it's fair. It's it's gross. It was packed. It was
still spring break.
Spring break. Yeah. A lot of I do every time I go solo. I feel like the dad with custody. I've said that before. I'm like, here's everyone's like, ooh, single dad taking his kids to Dave and Buster's on his 3 hour. You know, the 3 hours he gets. I was like,
visitation.
I'm still married. We have a good relationship. Everything's fine. Don't worry. It's yes, I am here. It's just she's working.
Just carry a sign around.
Showed everybody my wedding ring.
Hey, I'm still, how's it going, guys?
Still, I don't. This is not. This isn't visitation. I'm just parenting. I'm just being a father right now.
You guys want to go play that game or maybe that game over there?
So it's getting them out of there though is like pulling a tooth from a dog or something. Like you're just like, come on.
That's what the prize exchange is for at the end. That entices them.
I have a new bit.
What?
My new bit. Is, hey, dude, to Bo, he loves getting tickets. He loves winning stuff. I go, listen, let's save, because we'll come back. Let's rack up as many as we can. And he's like, oh, yeah. So,
now he wants to stay forever and collect tickets.
He just wants to go back.
If you can exchange, that's the ending point. That gets him out of there at the end. All right, we got a big show. We should get going, set the menu here. Coming up at 7 o'clock this morning, we will be joined in studio by comedian, actor, one-time sports talk radio host. Jay Mohr is going to be back with us.
I loved his show, by the way. You know,
he kind of pops in every once in a while to the Ben and Woods show. Has a great appearance. We have a ton of fun. Then we don't hear from him for a while, and then he's back. And
I love him so much.
He's always kind enough to come in studio when he's in town. We really appreciate it and look forward to chatting with Jay Mohr. Have no idea how long he's going to stay. It's been one segment. It's been two. It's been
2 hours.
Hours sometimes. And he gets to really pretty much dictate how long he wants to be here and what his schedule's like. But it starts at 7, and it ends when it ends, so we might push back some of our normal 7 o'clock hour stuff, like Take on Woods and Don't Do This. We'll just have to play it by ear on a Friday. Now, at 8 o'clock, it is, once again, the return of our friends Jake and Jordan from Cespedes Family BBQ. What day did we have him on last year?
We had him on Monday.
Mondays that last year.
That's a user error on our part.
Yeah, we've upgraded to Fridays.
It's a better fit for them.
They will alternate like they did last year, but today we'll get both of them. We'll get a nice, like our own round table with the Cespedes Family BBQ guys at 8 o'clock this morning. Discuss the first full week of the baseball season now in the books. And they've moved on to Yahoo as their kind of platform host, which is exciting for them. That's a new change. And we'll discuss all of that with Jake and Jordan coming up at 8 o'clock. And then we'll get to some of our normal stuff probably in our 8 o'clock hour, like the Reindl Report, because at 9 o'clock it is a Friar Friday. And we are both so excited this year that we've got Mike Shildt locked in on a weekly basis so we can just have this ongoing running dialogue with Mike Shildt and, you know, see how the last week went, you know, talk about any issues going on with the team, but we can also keep it light and, you know, just see how things are going as well and have our Friar Friday conversation. Our manager's report brought to you by San Diego County Credit Union at 9 o'clock with Padres skipper Mike Shildt.
Pretty cool that I talked to Paulie yesterday and he said, he goes, man, Shildt has been such a pro. And he said, you know, we don't know what the record's going to look like at the end of the year and how Padres fans are going to be feeling about him then. Little things, though. Paulie says, hey, Mike, you good tomorrow? 10 seconds. 10 seconds. He responds every time. He's been very open, man. Very, very open. So I really appreciate that.
I thought it was interesting during our roundtable yesterday. We started early with a little just evaluation of Mike Shildt and what you've seen so far. And we have a pretty...
I heard it.
You did hear that.
Yeah, I heard that part.
And I don't know that it was the best radio, because we all pretty much agreed.
Yeah.
And what is interesting is that it's a pretty disparate group. We've got Tony, the former player. We've got Annie, who's covered the team closely. We've got Craig, analytically driven. We've got Chris, who usually hates everything and everyone most of the time. And yet all of them, and me, pretty much had
and
nice...
And you like stuff.
And I like stuff.
Yeah. So does he.
But we all had different good things to say about Mike Shildt. He wins over kind of everyone. I mean, he's analytically driven enough for Craig. But
I just like the way the lineup flows. Yeah.
I like Mexican food.
Yes.
I like continuity.
I like rhubarb pie.
Yep. I like him in the leadoff spot. Yep.
I like pie gal poker.
Yep. I like the fact that he takes good at-bats.
I like more of a small derriere.
Yeah. I like the fact that we've had some production at the bottom of the order.
I like those little Smarties rolls.
I liked a lot about Xander Weedenoff. Yeah.
I like how I've kind of set up my life.
Yeah. There it is.
He's old school enough for Chris. He's player friendly enough for Tony.
He really kind of
he's got that good light touch that Annie seemed to enjoy that I liked as well. It's funny how even with a losing record at 4-5, no one is going, yeah, Mike Shildt's not the answer here. Don't like what I've seen from Mike Shildt. And I tend to think the Padres fan base agrees as well so far.
The only criticism I've seen of him so far is guess what? Take one wild guess.
Would it be bullpen management?
It would be bullpen management. And anytime a bullpen implodes and you're a new manager, that's the rap you're going to get. It just, there is no magic. There's no magic button to push.
But even that, he's gotten some praise for being aggressive with Robert Suarez
and
the five-out save and things like that. Yeah, a bunch of guys have blown up on him, but it's not like he keeps going to the same guy and keeps getting burned.
Right. I mean, he did it's with Brito twice, and then the next time he went to Brito, he was great for a long relief. Again, I think I'm not going to give you this early. I want these cats to win as many games now. These games matter. They matter so much. In regards to managing the bullpen, you almost have to wait. Unless everybody comes out of the gate shooting and perfect, and you're like, oh, this is easy. I got six guys I can choose from that are effective. It hasn't gone well for a lot of teams right now with their bullpens, a lot of teams. So as they try to figure out, that's really the only area I feel like I will give a little bit of leeway is managing the bullpen, because you have to see what you have and how effective they are. But he's been great so far.
And then we'll wrap up the show. It's a day baseball today, so we'll get you ready for the Padres and the Giants. It's their opening day. So it's their home opener at 1:35. Everyone gets to line up on the baselines once again and get introduced.
Cool.
It feels like we saw them rather recently. Bob Melvin and his crew taking on the same team again. The quick return to face the San Francisco Giants, and got a rematch of Saturday's game. It's Dylan Cease and Jordan Hicks which Padres looking to flip the script on that one. But we'll talk about today's game coming up in our final hour. But when we come back, since I brought up the roundtable, everyone agreed on Mike Shildt, but there was one topic in which pretty much everybody had a different opinion on. And I would love to get your opinion, Woods, on the last piece, essentially.
Yeah.
With the news yesterday, the rumors about trades with the Miami Marlins.
Make no mistake, everybody agrees they're a piece away.
Everyone agrees, but everyone kind of disagreed as to who that piece is. The free agents that are remaining, Tommy Pham, Brandon Belt, still out there. Is it a pitcher like a Jesus Luzardo? Who is the last piece? And will AJ go out and get that last piece? Want to talk about that when we come back. With more Ben and Woods on a Friday morning, and then Jay Mohr at the top of the hour here on San Diego's number one sports station, 97.3 The Fan.
What are you doing?
Listening.
I know.
Go ahead.
You wasn't even listening.
You're not supposed to talk over Black Betty.
I know. I was talking to both of you guys.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
All right. So I was seeing Diana in the chat reporting live from the airport, Lindbergh Field. Lots of Padres fans heading to San Francisco.
I love it.
It would be nice to see some brown and gold in addition to all the orange up there at Oracle Park today. We always talk about the opposing fans who love coming to San Diego to catch a game. Why not show up and show out for the opening day in San Francisco for the game today? So
I think the family, we're planning a trip up there in September, I believe, when the Pods are up there again. To go to Oracle. I'm really excited to see that ballpark. I saw it from afar, kind of walked past it. Looks incredible. Yeah, I want to go watch a game there sooner than later because it looks spectacular. But yeah, that's awesome. I mean, Padre fans, bro, they show up, they show out, they have been. Now let's give them a winner.
I'm talking about that final piece that we have been talking about for a few weeks now. But there's some interesting other potential options. We'll do that right after a check of traffic on 97.3 The Fan.
From the 97.3 The Fan Traffic Center, here's Kelly Davick.
Traffic is sponsored by Valvoline Instant Drive Through Oil Change, your 15-minute instant drive through oil change. Definitely want to leave extra time for travel this morning, guys. Slick.
All right.
All right. Thank you, Kelly. On your way to... She slid off the road during traffic.
She goes, leave some extra time for travel today, Slick. And that's it.
Hope she's okay.
Right, we'll check in on Kelly in a little bit. If you're on your way into work, want to keep listening to us, even after you park your car, the Odyssey app and odyssey.com, you can do it. Just download the app or visit odyssey.com. Search 97.3 The Fan and click on our show. Download the Odyssey app today to get started. So, yeah, during the roundtable yesterday, which you missed, getting your stitches out, the last 15 minutes or so were devoted to the last piece. And as you said, everybody agreed.
Yes.
The Padres need one more piece, and pretty much everyone thought it's got to be one more bat. Even though the offense actually has outperformed the pitching staff so far, we feel like that's a small sample size thing, that eventually the Padres just need one more bat. And everyone kind of had their own opinions as to who it should be. Do you trade prospects for Luis Arraez, who just seems to be more and more available every day as the Miami Marlins now... The only team without a win in baseball. They fell to 0-8. They had a lead yesterday.
Their bullpen is shot. And
they lost Yuri Perez now for the season because he's going to have
20 years old.
Tommy John surgery. In addition, of course, Sandy Alcantara also out for the season.
Yeah.
With Tommy John surgery.
I think Skip's lost 4 of his 5 starters.
He's got 2 other pitchers that are on the injured list right now.
Braxton Garrett
and one other guy who I think is on rehab and might be coming back. But it's been a nightmare of a start for Skip Schumacher's Marlins.
I love you. I'm sorry.
Does lead to, of course, you know, early speculation about trades. And Luis Arraez. There's also Jesus Luzardo, who the Padres apparently have coveted both of those guys. Now, if you're the Marlins, you certainly aren't giving them away. You're looking for prospects and top prospects, and we'll see if a deal can be made. But that's one option out there for the final piece. The others are the free agents, the top bats that remain in Tommy Pham and Brandon Belt. And everyone kind of had a different opinion. Tony Gwynn Jr. He's all in on Tommy Pham. He thinks that Tommy Pham is the guy they need in that clubhouse with his attitude, with his edge, his swagger to come in, and he can play the field competently in outfield. He's the most versatile option that is available right now, and you don't have to give up any prospects and probably less money even than Brandon Belt. So there's a lot of good arguments for Tommy Pham. There was a big call for Luis Arraez. I've seen people say perfect for Petco Park.
Yeah.
Guy just hits. The guy hits. And everyone said, Craig said, boy, wouldn't it be nice to see, you know, a guy like that, a Tony Gwynn-like batter at Petco Park, you know, putting up a close to 400 on base percentage, hitting over 300, challenging for a batting title, getting on base and, you know, being a guy that can bat in front of a Fernando Tatis Jr. or a Manny Machado, and you know he's always going to be out there causing some havoc. But there was also a good Brandon Belt contingent. He's the left-handed option. He's coming off a great season last year And he could slide right in and be a guy who is extremely productive. Drive in runs, maybe the most power of anyone that's available, obviously, on the market to add some home runs for the Padres. Everyone had an opinion. There was no consensus as to who A.J. Preller should go after, just that he needs to add that one last piece somehow, and it needs to get done before other teams jump in and swoop one of these guys away. What would have your take been on the round table?
It's one of the tougher things that we've been presented with this early in the season, I think. Arraez is, like you said, he's built for Petco Park. A lot of guys have good careers, come here, and it doesn't work for whatever reason, right? If you promise me, you swear to me that nothing changes with Luis Arraez, nothing changes at all, there's no drop-off, fine. Yes, absolutely.
Can't promise that.
Promise
He's
me.
Actually off to a pretty slow start this year.
But I need you to promise me that if we trade, you know, 2-3 prospects, whatever, and fork over the prorated $10.6 million, no drop-off.
No
Zero.
Promises. Could be like Juan Soto coming in. Still a great player, but unfortunately, instead of 340, he's now hitting 270
right.
without much power.
Right.
And all of a sudden, he doesn't look like quite as valuable of a player.
That's exactly right.
I mean, he's not going to keep hitting 200 this year.
He's
too talented.
So
that's not good. That's not going to happen. But he's not necessarily going to win a third straight batting title. There's no even Tony Gwynn had a few years where he didn't win
the batting title.
He won 8 of them, but he had, you know, 12 other seasons where he didn't win the batting title.
I need you to promise me that there's not going to be any significant drop off from his career numbers, and then he's a no brainer.
And the point was made also, and I think we even talked about it yesterday. He has some experience in left field, like 300 innings, something like that, 40, 50 games in left field. So he's been out there. He's obviously a second baseman, but ultimately the Padres need a designated hitter. And I didn't, you know, with all the voices, I didn't really have a chance to say this, but I'm okay. If one of the, you know, if Jurickson Profar got hurt, someone went down, I would love to see Jacob Marcy, some of the young guys, getting an opportunity to both play in the field and hit. Or if Graham Pauly was an everyday player. I don't want one of the young guys to come up and just be a DH right away. I don't mind a veteran like Tommy Pham, Brandon Belt, or even Luis Arraez being the designated hitter for the San Diego Padres. That job almost certainly should go to a veteran guy who's been in the league for many years.
100%.
It's a hard job to do. And to ask a rookie to come in and say, okay, it's time to be a big leaguer, but you're only getting to hit, and you're sitting on the bench the rest of the game. You're just adding to the degree of difficulty and really hurting your chances of success. So if the idea is when Manny goes back to third, like Graham Pauly's going to be the DH? No. Tyler Wade is your DH?
No.
Come on.
No.
Come on. He's a versatile player.
Very.
I like
great
coming
off the bench.
The speed, you know, he certainly spot start. I'm fine with that. Eggy? No. He's too young. I don't want him as the DH. You need a veteran designated hitter once Manny returns to third base. You just need it.
We are in such a interesting time as Padre fans, and Abraham in the chat sparked my brain here for a sec. He said, take this season to develop and create a superstar within the farm system. Yes, okay, they need to do that. And I think they are on their way with a couple of the arms that they have and potentially a couple of the bats they have as well. That being said, Abraham and all Padres fans out there, this year, when you cut $92 million from your payroll, everybody made the grand proclamation that this is a transition year. We've got to get under the cap. Yes, that is something. We have to reset the cap. No one in this room, I don't think really anyone in this fan base, disagrees with that method. You need to reset that.
For whatever reason. They needed to take out a $50 million loan. Major League Baseball says you're out of compliance
Correct.
With the debt service rules. You want to be able to keep your draft picks and international pool money to
Correct.
Sign Roky Sasaki. There are
a lot of good reasons, man,
that they need a reset and to get under the cap this year.
What a crap position to be in, though, if you're A.J. Preller. And, you know, we all saw the article come out last week that says this potentially could be it. So how do you, knowing it potentially is your last year, how do you in good conscience go, no, I'm going to just wait for Marcy to... How do you not go, all right, I'm going to trade so-and-so and so-and-so for him, and will he, 10 days into the season, fall back into what he's done every single year and just start unloading prospects for mercenary-type talent that comes here and underperforms for a couple of years of control? That's a weird corner to be painted into, is it not? Like, is this a transition year? You're going to have to do more with less. We all agree that there's still talent on this team. We all agree that the talent on this team is incredible and has the potential to be even better. But how do you, Ben, say, all right, like, let's just, are you going to be comfortable with him going and trading Snelling and Dylan Head and Homer Bush Jr. for 2 years of control with Arias? Knowing it could, if he doesn't make the playoffs, it could be his last year.
Craig made the point, and tell me if you agree or disagree. He said, Luis Arias is great, but his value isn't even as high as Dylan Cease. You shouldn't have to offer even as much as you did for Dylan Cease to get Luis Arias. If that's the case, he's like, okay, one good prospect.
One.
You know, we're not talking
three.
Ethan Salas.
Right.
We're not talking three. We're talking one of your maybe upper-level prospects and then a couple of lower-level guys. If that's not enough to get Luis Arias,
then have to walk.
Then maybe you have to walk away from that conversation.
We have this discussion almost every year. Who's the untouchables? Is it just Ethan Salas? Are there more untouchables? Is anybody truly untouchable?
I mean,
Dylan Lesko might be.
Robbie Snelling, left-hander, like... Yeah, those are the first guys they ask for. But, you know, listen, Luis Arias is going to come in, he's going to hit a single, and that's great. And you need a guy that's going to come in and get 200 of those. And that's
last year.
Now, but we also had Juan Soto, who's an on-base percentage machine last year. He also can hit the ball out of the ballpark. He got on a lot, didn't score a bunch. It's not on Arias to change this team. It's on Manny, and it's on Fernando, and it's on Xander. The guys with the big contracts that are here, everyone's I still hear people saying, oh, you know, Crony needs to have a big year. Fine. Jake Cronenworth makes $10 million a year. He does need to have a good year. He needs to bounce back. Manny, Tatis, and Xander have to perform on this team for it to do anything. It doesn't matter who you bring in. It doesn't matter if a guy gets on base 3 out of 4 at bats. If he doesn't score, what's the point? You know, so... That's where my head is kind of at with that. So would I love Arias? Yes. Do I want to overpay for him? No. Brandon Belt. The only thing I worry about with Brandon Belt is I pulled up his injury history. Bro, how long? I mean, I know he had a good year last year. How healthy is he? Is he going to continue to stay healthy? Because if he's here for a few million dollars, but he doesn't play, that does us no good. Tommy Pham, is he going to? He was horrible here. But for all the reasons Tony Gwynn Jr. listed, I can also be bought in, especially on the cheap, and I don't have to give up any prospects. He may be the best fit. The only thing is, he's a right-hander.
Here, what game is A.J. Preller playing right now?
I don't know.
He's told us, you know, they're constant discussions. They're not necessarily done. He's said that out loud.
Sure.
And while you can't always believe everything A.J. says, he said, I'm still looking. You know, we're not done talking to free agents, trade market. The discussions continue. Has he been playing the patient game with Tommy Pham? Like, I am more than happy waiting you out because I may need to pull off a trade. And if I acquire Luis Arias, I can't afford Tommy Pham or Brandon Belt and stay under the luxury tax. So is he waiting to see what's the best deal I can get for one of those three guys? And eventually he's going to pull the trigger on one of them. Is that the game that A.J. Preller is playing right now? And we're just kind of waiting to see what happens. If the price comes down on a rise, they go the trade route. If it doesn't, then maybe he ups his offer a touch to Tommy Pham and says, okay, sign on the dotted line. We're ready to go. But once you make your decision, you're locked in.
Yeah.
You can't undo it because then you don't have a lot of flexibility after that. So you got
to
get it right.
You have to make it right. It's got to be right.
You got to make the right call on one of these three potentially guys. Or, you know, it's AJ. There could be a mystery trade out there that we haven't even considered, but... That, to me, is the game I think that AJ is playing right now.
No one can make a 100% bulletproof case for any of these guys. I mean, really. Nobody can say, Brandon Belt's going to come here and he's going to hit 25 to 30 home runs and he's going to stay healthy. No one can say Luis Arraez is going to continue at his torrid pace that he has. And again, I'll pound that point in the ground. You got to get him in. He will get on. You got to get him in. You had Juan Soto on base 4 out of 10 times last year. You know, I mean, so we have guys that can get on base. Doesn't mean we're going to have a good offense. It falls on the guys that I mentioned, Tatis, Xander, Manny. The big money guys need to have big money seasons.
And I've seen in the chat a couple of people mentioned, hey, I'd rather have Jesus Luzardo and just go
nasty.
Deeper pitching staff, another proven top flight starter to go with Cease and King and Darvish and Musgrove. And then you've got unmatched depth in a top five in a starting rotation in baseball if you went that direction. There's an argument there as well. I just don't think you can do more than one thing.
Yeah.
Probably.
Yeah, and then the deadline comes around, and it's like, well, we really need a top-of-the-rotation guy, or we need a bullpen guy, and will you have the money to go out and get it? I mean, you know AJ's wants to, you know he wants to help the bullpen at the deadline. He does, even 8 days in, even if they're lights out until July, he's going to want to add a bullpen piece.
There'll be a Taylor Rogers
Scott
type
Barlow,
guy, someone available
always,
out there.
Always something. You got to have the flexibility for that move that you 100% know is coming. You 100% can book it. He's going to improve the bullpen at the deadline. He always does. He tries to. So I don't have a clear answer for you. I really don't. If they got anybody, I'm like, cool, great, let's go. But it's got to be right. You can't get two or three of those guys, I don't
think.
The
answer, though, is they need somebody.
They need to hit it
right.
They
need one more piece.
But they absolutely do.
All right, 1 hour in the books. Jay Mohr should be arriving soon. So.
He's here.
Oh, he's here. All right, so we're going to go let him into the building. Is a Hollywood star just waiting outside our door right now?
Yeah, sure is.
That's not good. Someone go get Jay Mohr. We'll come back with a second hour of Ben and Woods on a Friday morning here on San Diego's number one sports station, 97.3 The Fan. are live here until 10 a.m. on 97.3 The Fan. And it is our pleasure. Paulie, do you need a second to get everything set? You're good to go. All right. It's our pleasure to welcome back. He's in town this weekend. I believe Comedy Store in La Jolla. Jay Mohr is back with us here on 97.3 The Fan. Jay, it's great to see you again.
Yes! Thank you, boys.
Look at you're awake at 7 a.m.
You fake it till you make it,
that's
right?
That's right. That's what we do every morning.
You can be a mope or you can just go with the flow. Come on, San Diego, La Jolla, Chula Vista, show me your lightning bolts. Come on.
Our buddy. Yeah. Oh, man.
The best fifth starting there.
We were just talking about when you did sports radio. I liked your show a lot. I listened to it all the time. That's do you funny. Miss doing this? Probably not.
No.
Yeah.
It's a stamina that you can't prepare for the stamina of every flipping day.
It's gnarly.
And if you're national, you can only talk about the Cowboys so much before you want to kill yourself.
It's just over.
Like, why can't I drown?
Right.
Like, why can't I just drown?
Yeah.
Why can't they just find my lifeless body, pin a Cowboy star on my back?
Call it a day.
Did you Cowboys. Do 3 hours or 4 hours?
Three. It was not
three.
We do four.
So, yeah, we do four. He complains every single day about it.
Every day. Gnarly.
Which
every
is a putz.
I did five Save yesterday.
Guy's got it made. He gets to do radio in San Diego. You got cut.
Yeah, all the teams to choose from. It makes it so fun. Right?
Well, it's not my. You guys could have voted the Chargers to stay. You didn't even vote for them to stay.
It's not our fault.
It was on the presidential ballot.
You were going to the polls anyway. It's all about the
And you
owners.
Know what Spanos did? He went from renting here to renting there.
Yeah, I know.
What kind of billionaire are you? What kind of people are these, Henry?
Not every owner is a good owner like Jeannie Buss or Peter Seidler was.
He was so excited that you were coming.
What was the second name you dropped?
Peter Seidler. He passed away.
He was our owner here.
Padres owner actually like spent money on the team the last few years, wanted to win a World Series more than anything.
How'd that work out?
Well, you're a Met fan, aren't you?
What?
I thought you were a Met fan.
What is Mets?
I thought you were a Mets fan.
Say it again.
I thought you were a Mets fan.
I thought you said I'm a right Spider.
I thought you said.
No, I'm not a right. You dizzy bastard, get my drink. Make him call for the drink. Ben Casey. Bastard.
You're not all right, Spider. How is your lovely Mrs. Buss?
Oh, she's
Mrs.
great.
Mohr.
Mrs. Mohr, yeah.
Yeah, Ben was really excited to have you in because he wanted to talk Lakers basketball.
Lakers are hot right now.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know anything about them. Sacramento lost last night, so you got to get past one of those teams and get out of the 9 seed.
I can't believe you're doing this right now.
I know, but we talk about it all the
time. And now, please welcome your Chicago Bulls.
This is what we play for him, basketball, Ben, when he goes on his basketball Laker tangent.
He's a sports talk radio show host who hates basketball.
I don't like it.
You hate basketball.
I don't like it that much. I used to, but I don't need
If the Lakers had the record this year that... If they had this year's record last year, they'd be a 4 seed.
Right. Yeah.
The West is nuts.
So deep.
When you look in the standings, it'll say like last 10 games, it's all just 8-2, 7-3, 8-2, 7-3, 7-3, 7-3, 7-3.
It's weird. I don't mind when you talk basketball. Just him. I can listen to you talk basketball all day. You know what I'm saying?
You know why? Just look at his face. Just look at him. How come I don't get one of those cool lights that you Instagrammers have?
Oh, yeah.
We should get a celebrity the light.
You look better than the
ground, Polly. We don't need... We're beyond help, so it really doesn't matter.
Good radio, Woods. Fix the lights.
I know. I'm sorry. How's everything else, man? What else are you working on? I know you're doing stand-up, but what else are you doing? You getting scripts and stuff? Of course.
No, I'm out of show business. Yeah.
Well, I see you on a lot of podcasts.
Yeah, why does the board op have a light?
The board op? Oh, well, no. He's executive producer.
Please.
Until they bring in an Asian woman.
He's called me a putz and Pauly the board op since he got here. And called you annoying.
Yeah.
This is why I love having Jay.
I didn't call him annoying.
You called me annoying.
You did.
I did not say the word annoying.
Yes, you did.
Yeah. Did I?
Yeah.
I think that was exactly the word you used.
Run the tape.
Yeah. Paulie's good at running the tape back.
I'm in this movie, Sweet Dreams, that a buddy of mine directed and wrote. Johnny Knoxville goes to sober living, right?
Yeah.
And I play his sponsor. I was so fat in this movie.
Why?
Because I got fat. I was fat
after
last time
you got sober?
You weren't fat when you were here last.
I gained 70 pounds when I got sober.
No.
I was
we saw you in studio. You didn't. I mean, you definitely look good now.
I was 238.
You look in shape
now. I'm 235, so.
Yeah, but you're like 6'9". What did you say?
Suck it.
Yeah. I thought you never. Whoa. You know I was in rehab, right?
I do. So you got to play. You got to play a sponsor, which how was that for you? Now you've been on the other side, where you know what I mean.
You just say the lines that are written.
Yeah, same
there's
thing.
No like, wow, this really speaks to me. This
I'm
part.
Getting
you're
into
not,
this.
You're not
yeah.
Stanislavski method. Over
no,
there.
You just where do you want me to stand? And what I'm not smart enough to pull that. Here's how I act. Not my turn. Not my turn. Go,
Daniel Day Lewis. You got to get in character for like 4 weeks before you can even utter a line.
Four. Then I retire and become a cobbler.
So that's gonna. When's that coming out, or is it already out?
It's gonna be out like next week. It's called Sweet Dreams. Theo Vaughn's in it. Bobby Lee's in it, and Johnny Knoxville, obviously. Yeah, you know, I just sold a show, an unscripted show, to CW.
Busy.
But you know, who cares what you know? It's all blah 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 until it's out.
That's true.
We were actually going through your filmography yesterday.
Can you tell where my addiction got really bad?
Hold on. Pull it up again. Do you have it in front of you? I'll tell you exactly where.
Let's go back to... So I had forgotten a few, like Pay It Forward was one that I had forgotten about. You were the journalist in that.
You were great in that?
That was a sad movie. That was a really sad movie.
That's an interesting part because my entire part could have been replaced by a spinning headline. I just keep showing up going, the movement has reached Los Angeles. Everybody loves this thing. They just spin the headline.
What was your favorite?
Cousin Mike, Groomsman.
It's my favorite movie you've done.
Not even close.
It's my favorite movie you've ever done. It's so under the radar. Edward Burns, he wrote and directed that. Yes,
I love
it.
Yes.
It's one of my favorite movies of all time.
And like when I die, I'll be like, yo, check out Cousin Mike and Groomsman. Yeah, I acted.
You did great in that.
Standing by the ice cream truck. What are you doing? You didn't talk to me for 8 years because you were gay?
Yes, so
I'm going with
so
sometime
good.
Right after the incredible Burt Wonderstone.
No, Burt Wonderstone was great.
No, after that.
But what's after it?
Dumbbells, Road Hard, and then a 3-year gap until All About
there
Nina.
There it is. And then what's after Nina?
American Nightmares, Hollow Point, and then a 4-year gap.
You don't even know what Hollow Point is?
American Nightmares.
You were Raymond, according to your filmography.
Raymond.
Played Raymond.
He doesn't even remember.
I'm waiting for you to get to the Talking Dog movie.
Which one was the Talking Dog? Air. No.
Jesus.
What's the Air was Air. The great movie.
Oh, that was a good one. Yeah. I don't see a Talking Dog movie
What was
here.
The Talking Dog movie?
Paparazzi?
Paparazzi, was that just right TV or something? Was that actually out in theaters?
I don't even think they put it on your IMDb, actually. They left it all off. Did you get paid for that?
I'm not, cash. Right up my nose.
Trade.
I'm not even like a lead dog. Oh. I'm like a salesman at Chewy Vuitton.
Are you sure they didn't edit you out? Paparazzi, there it is. 2019. Paparazzi.
So 2019, 2020 is the sweet spot. Why are Jay's boogers blue and orange?
It's when we met you the first time, and you came into our old studio at Mighty 1090, and you stayed for like 2 hours, and it was the greatest. We had a great time.
Yeah, that was a good time, Charlie.
We also realized anyone who sticks around hanging with us for 2 hours probably has an issue.
Probably
now
on drugs.
I'm sober. I'm not going to go. See you.
Yeah. So good to see you again. Joined in studio by the great Jay Mohr. We were talking about Bob Sugar, of course. That's probably, you get a lot of Bob Sugar still to this day. And we wanted, I said to the guys earlier in the week, I go, we've had him, he does walk in everywhere he goes.
Of course. It's crazy. All right, there you go. What's next?
But I said, how did we get him to do it again? Do you mind doing it?
I mean, they're copying you for Super Bowl ads now.
Yes.
And they're actually making it a bit on a Super Bowl ad, getting everybody to do a walk-in.
First person I thought of was you. Christopher, you saw that ad?
How was I not in that?
How were you not in that? Who's your agent? He's got to go.
Reuben Kincaid.
He's got to go. Come on, Reuben. Like, he's got to go.
Does anybody get that reference? Reuben Kincaid?
Uh-uh.
Goes to Partridge Family's agent.
Oh, wow.
I'm not.
It's 97.3. You don't say the points. FM, the fan. Yeah. Sports talk, radio. That's all.
That's it. That's all I needed.
What else do you want?
No, that's it. That's all I needed. You're listening to Ben and Woods.
I'm not going to say that. You know, Norm MacDonald. You know, I always listen to Ben and Woods, you know. I'm not sure why, you know, because one guy, he likes to talk NBA basketball, you know. But the other guy, the Woods guy, he says, hey, do me a favor. Don't talk NBA basketball.
So good. That'll be a promo for us very much.
All right, now you do an impression.
Woods actually is not bad.
I am. I mean,
let me hear
I'm
you do. You can do Peter Griffin. Good Will Hunting. I love Good Will Hunting.
Oh. Whatever I say, you got to just try it right away.
I don't know. I didn't watch Family Guy.
This is a.
That's
a
not the game.
Give me somebody that's not a cartoon.
Liam Neeson. Right away, go.
You can't even think about it. You got to go.
You know what?
I have a
specific set of skills. And
yeah,
if you're going to.
Yeah, if he was on the Lucky Charms box. Yeah. It's a fun game. You're out of the band.
Jake, he can't do accents.
Woods says the Irish accent is the hardest. We played some of the best actors
in the world
trying to do Irish.
Yeah. You know,
Tom Cruise, they're all horrible at it.
It's my hat.
It's the worst.
Everybody in Gangs of New York is horrible.
That's terrible. Yeah, everyone's terrible.
But that opium den with everybody's boobs are out, just fooling around. Every nook and cranny's got somebody getting it in. I'm like, ooh, maybe I need to go back in time and not know what it's like to brush teeth or wipe butts.
Right, seriously.
No, it's corn cobs.
I do Boston's.
No, you're done.
Yeah, am I done?
You're out.
That's fine. I'm not going to do it then. That's good. That's all right.
At least I tried.
Yeah, you did.
So, Ben, ready? I'll give you one.
Give another one.
But you got to go immediately. Morgan Freeman. Perfect. No, because he
Andy
went.
Andy Dufresne crawled through 500 yards.
You're out of the band.
I'm not.
Shut
of
up.
Of the foulest smelling.
I hope you drown.
You really got the wrong guy for this. You should have jumped in because you're so much
better
than
I am. I didn't know how to do.
Good old Andy. Crawled through a mile of you-know-what, came out the other side. Some birds weren't meant to sing, fly. I've messed it up.
So good, though. So good.
All right. Ready, Ben?
Yeah. One more time.
Sarah Silverman.
I don't know what she sounds like.
You don't get the game.
No, we don't. We're not impressionists.
That's the fun part is that you just have to be willing to return serve.
You're right. I choke.
You always say play along.
Do you play golf with the club pro and go, I'm not a pro. I can't hit it.
Yes.
Yeah, actually.
Yes.
That's a very good one's impression. Ball.
I always sit on this because I have a groin issue. So
a groin, as Terry Bradshaw says. A groin.
A groin.
He has a groin injury.
I lean on this all show.
Did you really?
Yeah, I do.
How'd you injure your groin?
Playing baseball.
What's his name? Hey, you want to hear my favorite joke? I'll try to clean it up.
Please clean it up.
Got the dump button.
Nah, I can't even tell it.
Can we take a quick break and then come back? And
you got time?
You can tell us your joke.
Want to hear an alcoholic joke?
Yes.
Alcoholic's on a deserted island. He finds a genie lamp. He rubs it. The genie says, I'll give you two wishes. He goes, all right, my first wish is I want a cocktail that never is empty. So he bang, boom. He's holding his big, tall, icy rum and a Coke. Starts chugging it. It never goes down. 3 hours go by. He's hammered. And the genie goes, you know, you have another wish. He goes, I'll have another one of these.
Fantastic. You got time to stick around for a couple minutes?
I don't get it, Jay Moores.
Yeah.
All right, good. All right, we're going to come back. More of Jay Moore in studio on San Diego's number one sports station, 97.3 The Fan. Let's check traffic with Kelly. Tune in every Thursday, 10 a.m. for 97.3 The Fan's commercial-free Padres Roundtable featuring Ben and Woods, Annie and Elston, Gwen and Chris, presented by San Diego Roundtable Pizza. For takeout or delivery, go to roundtablepizza.com. Roundtable, last honest pizza. We got Jay Mohr in studio. Comedy Store, how many shows this weekend? What's the details?
Five. Two Friday, two set. Two tonight. Two tonight. And two tomorrow night, and then one Sunday.
Okay. What's the act right now? I mean, what's the focus?
I talk about my intervention, going to rehab. I talk about what it's like to be married. I talk about planning a wedding in your 50s. I talk about having sons that are idiots.
How old are your sons?
13 and 21, different moms.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Good. Are they tight?
Well, one's in college, and one's 13. On his bottom bunk watching TikTok.
No,
that's all they do.
I got a 6-year-old and a 3-year-old, so I'm getting to that.
When my son was in third grade, he goes, I don't understand how my grades work because it's numbered like 1 through 4, right? I go, well, three, you get threes. That means you're in third grade, you're getting threes, you're right on grade level. Four is like, wow, this guy's like as smart as a fourth grader, right?
Right.
We're in the car driving when I'm telling this. I go, one is like you wear your underpants outside of your pants. We get to the next red light. I look out of the corner of my eye. He looks down like this. That's my son. My son's hilarious. My son,
I bet.
But you know what? We go bowling every Tuesday night, me and my wife and a couple friends. And then one night my friend flew in from Japan with his daughter. And so like it's eight of us just catching up, like in this little scrum. And my son, he was 12 at the time, 12 years old, and he walks up to my friend after 5 minutes. He goes, hey, I'm Mackie. I don't think I introduced myself. I'm Jay's son.
Nice.
And I was like, this guy could sell Learjets to billions. What am I worried about his grades for?
Yeah. I think we talked about it before. I think comedy has got to be the hardest thing in the world, to get up by yourself on a stage in front of an audience. And I have the utmost. Woods has tried it a couple of times.
It's nerve-wracking.
I mean, it's got to be absolutely terrifying.
You saw me. Now, you have to put me on the spot.
Do you do your Liam Neeson impression?
I will not do my Liam Neeson.
So this guy thought you had to come up with a different act every single time. So
I thought that too.
I did. Did you? I did it 5 times. I wrote 5 separate 10-minute acts.
Wow.
It was terrible.
You have an hour.
I'm like, yeah,
an
like
hour
50
of
minutes.
Yeah,
an hour of
material at all.
An hour of Kmart.
It was mostly about that.
Punching your clown?
Punching the clown. Yeah, mostly. You talk about what you know.
That's when I was really overweight. You ever pull a hamstring doing that? But you ride, you like just straighten your legs, start trembling.
I pulled a hamstring watching a baseball game on the couch.
He jumped off the...
Yes!
And pulled a hammy.
I kind of woke up with a pulled hammy last night. I think I just was dehydrated.
Oh, that's the worst. The cramp in the middle of the night when you're dehydrated.
When I went to my doctor, I did all this blood work because, you know, I got sober. I got to take care of my body. Got new teeth, new hair, blah, 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 blah. I got my blood panels done. And then he leaves me a voicemail. Hey, it's Dr. Foxman. When do you come in and we'll talk about the results of your blood panel?
Uh-oh.
And I was like, oh, God, I got AIDS again. I got it again. 3 times? Like, that's got to be a record. And it turns out I was fat. He wanted to talk to me about being fat, but he didn't say fat. He called me obese.
Obese.
And I talked. I turned into Joe Pesci. I'm like, I'm obese. You stuttering, mumbling. Where do you get your medical balls big enough to call me obese? You stuttering. I wanted to climb off the table and slap this guy, but it would have taken me like 4 minutes to climb off that table. And plus, the paper was stuck to my legs.
It's terrifying.
We did this
man.
Like medically, like if you go by height and weight, like 90% of
garbage.
The Padres
it's
roster
garbage,
is
right?
obese.
The BMI.
I'm morbidly obese.
According to the stats,
drop
all three of us are morbidly obese.
It's so scary to hear, too. Like, hey, man, you're going to have a stroke at some point, so stop eating Chick-fil-A every day.
If I'm 5'10", 190...
You're fine.
I'm probably 190 right now. I'd like to be 180, but whatever. But if I'm 5'10", 200, I'm an NFL running back.
That's exactly
But
right.
I don't look like an NFL running back. Right. I look like a guy with a belly.
Mm-hmm.
A belly. So we were talking about taking testosterone.
Yeah.
Oof.
It's fun.
There's some nice benefits to that.
Very nice benefits.
About 2 inches.
And you're right into it.
You don't sell that when you talk about West Coast men's health.
You just started.
One of those claims you can't make on the radio.
What's that?
You can't promise people something that.
No, you can't promise. Yeah. You can say it happened to me.
Jay's saying it happened to him.
When I started TRT like years ago, I thought I was dying. I didn't know what was the matter with me. And they're like, hey, man, you have the testosterone of a 98-year-old man. That's why you can't get out of bed.
At least they said man with you.
Exactly. But you're right. Like, you're about 6 weeks in?
Yeah. Not even four.
The fog, just starts to lift, and then you wake up.
I can't get off the preacher curl bench at the gym. I got one two short song over and over. Doing negatives.
I went to my trainer, and after he killed me one day, not anymore.
You should fire that guy.
I went to him. I go,
what does he have you work in, the water fountain?
I hate it. Just getting roasted. So he crushed me one day, and I had just started, and I go, is that all you got today? The recovery was really, it was really phenomenal. And you get why baby athletes do it. Why athletes do it sometimes.
You said baby athletes.
I didn't mean to. I meant regular athletes.
Baby athletes.
You get why athletes do it.
By the way, sign me up.
It's on ESPN. Which channel?
The Ocho.
Tommy in our chat says, in my fat days, I had a doctor write in his notes that I was grotesquely obese. Decided morbidly obese wasn't enough.
Grotesquely obese. That's when you can put your hands in your pockets naked. Grotesquely. Oh, Tommy?
That's a doctor's term. That was Tommy.
How did you gain all the weight?
Yeah.
Eating.
Eating, drinking.
Oh my! You look like a strip club DJ.
I do.
Yeah.
It's maybe the nicest thing anyone's ever said.
You look cool.
Thank you.
You look like you wear sweatpants to a funeral.
Let's give her a big Texas hell yeah!
They took me to my very first strip club.
48 years old.
A couple of months ago. 48 when we were in Arizona. Yeah.
But he'd never been.
I'd never been.
What'd you think?
It was fun.
Oh, he had a good time.
He fell in love. First
Delilah.
Delilah?
She's the one.
The first one.
Why Delilah?
We played it every day.
Delilah.
Every single day.
They're just magicians at getting it. Because I'm the big shot. I'm like, all right, you, and you. Back room.
She really cared. She had a heart of gold.
She did. She did.
She had a heart of gold.
Can you imagine doing that for a living? Sitting in your lap. Can you imagine sitting in Ben's lap for money?
She actually went upside down. She was very acrobatic.
It was the greatest thing I've ever. At one point, I looked over and he was standing on the side of the stage. He'd never been to one, and he was standing there with this grin, and he just goes like this, and he just throws dollar bills at the stage. I looked at Paulie. I go, I would get that tattooed. That image, if I was allowed to take pictures in here, I would get it tattooed right here.
Did you sneak back by yourself?
Everyone assumes that I did, but I had such a great experience. I don't want to sell you the memory.
We started here. There's nowhere to go but down with that.
We were at a strip when I was on Saturday Night Live. Me, Farley, Spade, Timmy Meadows. I forget. Maybe Sandler. We all go to the strip club, and bodybuilders will flex their individual pecs.
Their pecs.
This girl could do this. This Russian immigrant woman was coming over, and she's flip, 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 flip. Yeah, and then she's dancing for David Spade, and then two songs go by, and she comes back. And she's dancing for David Spade again. And she does it again. And Spade goes, seen it. And she just retired that moment. It's you just saw each bag deflate. Oh, I can't. It's I don't.
Not anymore.
We all crave Hollywood celebrity approval.
It's true.
It's a disease among us mere mortals.
Yeah,
so.
But she really liked you, Delilah.
She did.
Yeah, she did. No.
It's on the Reddit.
In the car ride on the way back, he's like, I feel like I could help coach her. Like I could help mentor her. Probably. Yeah.
Bring her to the batting cages. Work on her footwork.
The golf range.
She's got potential. That's for sure.
She does. For what?
Whatever she wants.
Whatever she
Jay,
wants to do.
Whatever she wants to do.
The sky's the limit. Yeah. The sky's the limit. It was his first time and only time.
If you're listening and you're a stripper, boo.
Oh, no. I don't know how big our contingent is.
Zero.
Exotic.
I'm going to go zero.
Probably right.
Zero. Why do you have a picture of Dave Roberts on the wall?
He's a San Diego guy, and we were tight back in the day, and so I got the picture with him. And
you look like Tom Cruise in that picture.
Then he became the manager of the Dodgers, and
actually have Tom Cruise's nose.
Thank you.
You look like him.
I've said that.
Not now.
All right, fine, whatever.
You look like Tom Cruise's older brother. How old are you?
48.
Oh, you're a younger brother than Tom Cruise.
Thank you. Tom's ageless, of course.
He's amazing.
Is he?
That is.
He's
the coolest
guy.
Is he the coolest guy?
Well, I just know him from the movie. We never hung out, but he was the nicest. Yeah, in my audition scene, my audition scene was firing him.
Yeah.
And I always, the whole thing with Bob Sugar was no matter how he's sitting, he's always looking down at you. I always had this diagonal eyes down. And then when we shot it in the restaurant, my seat was really low. And I was when your elbows are up on the table.
Yeah.
And I'm just doing the scene, And I was like, we did like two takes. And they're like, and he's like, what do you think? I go, my chair's too low in the audition. And before I could finish, he goes, Cameron, he needs a taller chair. And he gets up and like they're putting like furniture pads under my ass. And I'm like, wow. He goes, never underestimate how important everything is to your performance.
That's unreal.
I don't know why I just did Owen Wilson.
Wow.
Have you ever done your own stunts?
When I do Owen Wilson, I wind up sounding like Jennifer Coolidge. Yeah, with me and Keanu Reeves, our fight scene in Street Kings, these stunt guys rehearsed it for an entire day. They came in at noon, and like at midnight, they're like, okay, you got it. And they showed us. It's like we had to fight down the stairs, back up the stairs, out a window, onto the roof of a garage, off the garage, into the bushes, into the trunk of the car where he puts me. And they show us, and Keanu Reeves looks at me and goes, shall we dance?
Oh, my God. One take.
I'm like, well, you're Neo, bro. Let's do it.
That's going with the Matrix. Here.
And right before the fight scene, I walk past his trailer. He's in a wife beater and his jeans, and he's cutting a steak on a paper plate with a plastic knife and fork. I go, what are you doing? He goes, I have to get the blood up.
Oh, my.
Before our scene, I want to get the blood up. Get the blood up.
He seems like a really
good
guy.
He's a good guy.
He's a really
nice guy. And a friend of mine, a couple of friends of mine have bumped into him in Hollywood, like at different hotels. Yeah. And he's like, hey, I'm friends with so-and-so. One of my friends is a two-time national champion wrestler, Nick Soriano. And he's at the Olympic trials now. And his family was staying at the Chateau Marmont, and Keanu Reeves is there. And he goes, hey, I'm friends with Jay Moore. And he goes, oh, how do you know Jay? He goes, he coached me in wrestling. And he goes, but you're so much more than a wrestler. And now it's like his Instagram bio. So much more than a wrestler.
Anytime a Keanu Reeves story comes, he seems like a guy that's kind of laying low these days, but every story that comes out, he just seems like the greatest guy.
Yeah, he'll just quote Shakespeare and stuff to you.
He's like, all right, see you later.
But then when he acts, it's like a cigarette ad in the 50s, like, smoke Luckies. These hit my T-zone. The T stands for flavor.
We were asking yesterday, when did people stop talking like that?
Yeah, see?
Yeah.
Yeah, 2 minutes. Yeah, like that whole bit.
And they all talk so
fast.
You know what's fun to do on an old movie when they pick up the phone? Try to be the person on the other line and say anything. Hello. Yes. Really? Trolley? Springfield, Illinois? Got it.
So true.
Okay, so here's the information.
We had some people in the chat asking about your SNL days. How difficult was that?
It was impossible.
That whole...
Because you have no idea how to do it or what to do it. Like, everybody's writing sketches on a computer, and I didn't have a computer. I didn't know how to type. So I'm writing my sketches on a yellow legal pad, and you finish at 2 in the morning. You're like, where do I hand this in? They're like, just go...
You have to pitch, like, you go in at, like, a pitch meeting.
Yeah, that's the easier part.
Is it?
Well, I learned my second year the art of the fake pitch because I realized Kevin Nealon would pitch the same thing every week and not write it. He goes, I have an idea where you have a house. You live on top of one of those runaway truck ramps. And, like, at dinner, a truck just comes, you know, crashing through your wall. You know, and everyone would giggle, and he goes, yeah. And then the key phrase is, and I'm working with Ben on something.
You just
pick somebody in the room and go, I'm working with Woods on something. I'll tell you about it later. Because I would just give all my ideas in the pitch. And then when I wrote it with each joke that I already pitched, and it wouldn't get a laugh because they already heard all the jokes.
Right.
So it's like, and then this happens, and then this happens. Like me.
That's tough. Was it political? Oh, like,
no.
No favoritism and all that
well,
stuff?
Well, like, who's light this week? Who's got a movie coming out, I guess? That's maybe. Good. But, you know, it's if you stink, you stink. And I stunk.
Did you?
Yeah, I don't know what I'm doing.
How long were you on SNL?
2 years.
2 years?
Yeah.
That's decent run. That's a tough...
Ladies and gentlemen, Woods!
So some people get introduced, and then there's featuring.
I was one of those.
You were one of those. What's the difference, like, between the actual...
Just the title, I guess.
Just the title at the end.
Because I pitched Good Morning Brooklyn, which wound up going on twice, and I'm really proud of it. You know, it's a morning talk show. Like, Good Morning Brooklyn, how are you?
Yeah.
Yay. Now it's time for the beating of the week. The Beaten of the Week is brought to you by Paul Ianella and Sons, Little Red House of Sausage and Peppers, and Connie DePodesta's House of Class.
House of
class.
It's great.
So good. Just nailed so good. And so I had it for the Marissa Tomei because she was promoting my cousin Vinny. And then I'm walking her through the beats, and everyone's like, oh, that's a great idea. And I'm writing it, and it's coming out great. And then I'm talking to her like on a Friday. Like, it already got picked to be on the air. And she goes, wait, you're a featured performer? Like, she stepped in dog crap. And I'm like, yeah. And then, like, she wouldn't do it.
No, oh, no way! Yeah. You just ruined my image of Marissa Tomei.
And but then it wound up going up with Sarah Jessica Parker, and she was hilarious.
So
she,
good.
She kicks Chris Farley in the nuts. He's got a new karate dojo on Lemoyne Avenue. Please. And he comes in and he goes, okay, I'm a mugger. I want your purse. And she goes, get off of me, you mutt. And she kicks him in the nuts. He goes, that's not karate. You need me in my groin. Son of a... And he storms out.
Oh, my God.
That's not
man.
Karate. You kicked me in my groin.
That's amazing. I do, too. So much.
I'll tell my Chris Farley story this weekend at the La Jolla Comedy Store.
Yep.
Yeah, we paid him, me and Dave Attell paid him $100 to go to the bathroom out the window. 17th floor.
I think you told us this last time I think you were here.
Incredible. He's standing on a window ledge on the 17th floor just grinding.
Two. Number two.
Number two. We are out of time, although we have a Jay Moore rule. You can stay as long as you want, yeah. But if you got to get going, you're
hey
off the hook.
Hey, now. It's Bannon Woods, everybody. 97.3 with Board Op.
Board Op Pauly. Damn it.
Bob.
Thank you, man.
Pauly
Thanks so
Bob.
Much.
Thanks, boys. I love you.
Love
Great
you, too.
To see you, man. Comedy show, comedy store, four, five shows. Two tonight, five. Two tomorrow, Woo! One on Sunday. Go see Jay Moore. Have a laugh or two. We will be back with more Bennett Woods right after this on San Diego's number one sports station, 97.3 The Fan. Hurricane Jay has left the building. He was fantastic. It's always terrific when Jay Mohr is in studio.
So good, man.
I'm always absolutely terrified.
Even I am.
And 80% of it goes over my head, and I still love it.
Yeah, it's so good.
I mean, there's references. I've got no idea who he's talking about. Sometimes I look at you and I wonder, does Woods know who he's talking about?
So, like, which ones? You got the Goodfellas one, I'm assuming.
I got the Goodfellas one.
Okay.
Joe Pesci. You got that one,
yep.
For sure. Hey, there's just a couple of names that you drop in there.
There's a couple of names I didn't really know
don't
either.
Know who that is.
But man, he's good. He is. He just makes me laugh. He's always on. You know, even at the commercial breaks, he's great. Great dude.
What did he call you, Paulie?
Board Op Paul.
Board Op Paul.
Oh, Bop. B-O-P.
Board Op
Paul. I get it now. See, now I get it.
Yep.
You're a strip club DJ as well. I mean, you would be really good at that.
Is that a compliment or an insult?
I took it as a compliment.
Yeah. I don't know if he meant it as a compliment.
I don't think he did, but I mean, I'm not mad at it.
Take it over, though.
And he's not wrong, necessarily. Like, when I thought about it, I went, yeah. Like, I do have that. It's not even the voice, it's the look. I think I look like a strip club DJ. I do. I've never done that. I have friends that have. It's just weird. You see it?
I'm looking. I mean, I'm trying. I haven't been to many strip clubs. I don't remember what the DJ at Explicit looked like, actually.
I don't either.
But I think the voice works.
My voice?
The strip club.
It's not that hard.
All right, we're going to need a contestant for Take on Woods.
Okay.
Usually we play a little bit earlier, but your chance here to qualify for a trip to Las Vegas coming up here in just a couple of minutes. If you want to get online now, 833-288-0973. We got a two-night stay. We got tickets to Cool and the Gang as well. Got our musical trivia challenge, Tier 1 v. Woods coming up here, but you got to call in 833-288-0973. Mention that the Marlins are 0-8. They are the last winless team in baseball, Woods.
Jeez. They are.
The Mets finally got their first win yesterday. It came in the second game of a doubleheader. It also came on the same day that their own broadcaster, Gary Cohen, said, this has got to be rock bottom. They were winless. They lost the first game of the doubleheader. They had gone 13 innings without a hit. They were getting no hit in the second game and trailing 1-0 to the Detroit Tigers. And then they finally got a hit, and then they got two runs in the ninth on a Pete Alonso home run and a walk-off single and actually won the game 2-1. But how bad do you have to be in the first week of the season for your own broadcasters to be going, this is rock bottom?
Tough,
here.
Man. It was a rough week for our beloved Italian Paul, is a big Met fan, and I saw him going through it online. It happens. You know, it happens. I mean, that is a team. I don't know that they're capable of ripping off 8 in a row. I think every team is. Who was the team last year that had the long win streak that surprised everybody? I can't remember. It was somebody that we didn't really expect it to happen, but we were like, wow, okay, they keep winning. But yeah, the Mets really, really needed that dub yesterday.
And the Royals,
the
got another.
Was it the A's?
Did they go on a long way? Yeah, they did. They were like 7 in a row. We're going, Padres can't win 4 in a row,
right.
And the A's can win
seven.
Like 7 in a row.
That's right.
And then Royals got another great, outstanding effort from Seth Lugo.
Yeah.
6 2/3, 1 earned run. Through 2 starts, he's got a 0.71 ERA. They beat the White Sox 10-1, but a really nice start to the season for former Padre Seth Lugo, who signed as a free agent in Kansas City in the offseason.
Yeah, he's off to a really good start. Josh Hader, not so much in Houston. I think he's had a rough go of it so far, and I don't know. I mean, I don't know why we feel compelled to check on everyone that got away, but we do.
Is that an odd?
I mean,
doesn't every fan base do that and like see how the guys that used to play on their team at least for a while?
I'm not sure.
You're not going to follow Blake Snell this year with the Giants?
I'm not saying it's bad. I'm just wondering why we are compelled to do it. I'm as guilty as the next
one. We know them. I mean, we know them. We're curious. Are they going to continue? If they did well, are they going to continue to thrive? Are they going to take a step back? Did you make a mistake letting one of these guys get away?
That's the thing, too, is like you can't fix it. So I try not to give too much energy to it. But, you know, yeah, you're always going to look and go, you know, he really would help this rotation or this bullpen or whatever. But, you know, can't change it now. So, but we are compelled to do that. I am as guilty as the next.
Okay. That's just a natural inclination.
It's a natural inclination, yes.
All right, we're going to check traffic. Got a contestant on the line when we come back. A little delayed game of take on Woods.
From the 97.3 The Fan Traffic Center, here's Kelly Danik.
Well, for the most part, folks are doing a pretty good job of navigating our slick roadways, guys. Yeah, we've got some scattered showers hitting the county. Just one accident to mention here. This is in the North County, northbound 15, past the 76 vehicle spun out in the fast lane. I'm Kelly Danik with Ben and Woods, San Diego's number one sports station, 97.3 The Fan.
All right, let's see if we can get a winner to end the week. We got John as our contestant today. Good morning, John. How are you?
Good morning, guys.
All right, Woods has left the studio. You will go first. Five questions, musical trivia. If you beat or tie Woods, we'll put you into our grand prize drawing for the two-night stay at the Westgate Las Vegas Resort and Casino and two tickets to Cool and the Gang. Backed by popular demand, 2024 residency at the Westgate. You can get your tickets at Ticketmaster.com. All right, here are our categories for today's game. We got Chow Time, musical artists and songs, including the word eat. We got You Are My Sunshine, five musical answers, including the word sunshine. And our new category today is Light and Dark. Those are five song titles that include either the word light or the word dark. John, any of those sound good to you today?
The sunshine category.
Please. All right, You Are My Sunshine. So just a few days ago, we did a all 2 second song sunshine category. This one is just your traditional five questions, 60 seconds. If you don't know an answer, you can say pass. We'll come back to it if there's time at the end. First question is our 2 second song. Polly is going to play a little bit of a well-known hit. You need to give me the title and the artist to score that point. And remember, sunshine going to appear in every answer today. John, are you ready to play?
I'm ready.
All right, 60 seconds on the clock. Your time begins when Paul plays the music in the category You Are My Sunshine. Good luck, John. Let's take on Woods.
KCN, the Sunshine Band. That's the way I like it.
Correct. John Denver was stuck in a cold Minnesota winter when he wrote which number one hit that dreamed of warmer climates?
Yeah.
60s British rockers Cream had two top 10 hits in the U.S. White Room and which other?
Your Love.
Correct. Jim Gilstrap and Lonnie Groves are the other two voices you hear in which 1973 Stevie Wonder ballad rated by Rolling Stone
You're
is one of
the sunshine of my life.
Correct. The Fifth Dimension's Aquarius is joined by which other song in a 1960s medley written for the musical Hair?
Let the Sunshine.
Correct. Yeah. Let's go back to John Denver was stuck in a cold Minnesota winter when he wrote which number one hit that dreamed of warmer climates? Got some time.
Sunshine in the morning. You're so happy.
He sings it. He's got it.
Sunshine. My eyes make me cry.
That's the title.
You got like 2 seconds.
Sunshine.
You know what? You got four, and I think you got a good chance to win.
It's going to be a good score.
That is Sunshine on My Shoulders, and you're going to kick yourself there because I know you know the song. Good score, though, John. Four correct. That's the way I like it. Sunshine of your love. You are the sunshine of my life. Let the sunshine in. Let's bring Woods back in. See if he can do it without even knowing the category here. All right, John's score is locked in. Should be a good game here. Let's put 60 seconds on the clock. The time begins when Paul plays the music. Good luck, Woods. Let's take on John.
That's the way I like it. Casey and the Sunshine Band?
Correct. John Denver was stuck in a cold Minnesota winter when he wrote which number one hit that dreamed of warmer climates?
Rocky Mountain High.
Incorrect. 60s British rockers Cream had two top 10 hits in the U.S. White Room and which other song with a distinctive bass riff inspired by Jimi Hendrix?
Sunshine of Your Love.
Correct. Jim Gilstrap and Lonnie Groves are the other two voices you hear in which 1973 Stevie Wonder ballad rated by Rolling Stone as one of the greatest songs of all time?
Oh, pass.
The Fifth Dimension's Aquarius is joined by which other song in a 1960s medley written for the musical Hair?
This is the dawning of
you've got Aquarius,
the
then it always Aquarius. Goes into which other song?
I don't know.
You don't know that one? You know the category yet?
No. It's killing me. I think I'm screwed.
60s British rockers Cream had two top 10 hits.
One.
Oh, you got that one. That's right.
Oh.
Jim Gilstrap, Lenny Groves, the other two voices.
Stevie's is
is too late because John, with a score of four, is a winner today.
I wouldn't have gotten him.
So sunshine was the key word. Casey and the Sunshine Band. Sunshine on My Shoulders was the John Denver song. Sunshine of Your Love, you got You Are the Sunshine of My Life, and Let the Sunshine In.
Let the sunshine.
It always follows Age of Aquarius.
Look at that cream, Pauly. It's one of my...
John, congratulations. Hang on the line. Pauly is going... Paulie's going to get your information during the... you might have to wait a minute or two here for the top of the hour, but he will get your information. We'll put you into the drawing for Las Vegas. Congratulations. A well-played game. Tough category. That was actually 10 sunshine songs because we just did the two-second sunshine category a few days ago as well. I think I've exhausted...
We did?
Yeah, there was a whole two-second song category of sunshine songs just a couple of days ago. I think I've exhausted all of the sunshine songs out there. For those two categories this week.
You must have been in a positive mood.
I was. Yeah, it was a good week. At our first pitch. I mean, the last couple of weeks have been a whirlwind. Between the 3 a.m. watch party for the Soul Series at Seven Mile Casino, opening day and all the festivities we had, our first pitch, it has been quite the last couple of weeks.
Yeah, I'm exhausted.
Here on the Benowitz program.
That's exactly right.
And now we're turning our attention to what is next in the Ben & Woods calendar, which is hopefully planning our Ben & Woods Open Golf Tournament.
Yes.
Which we will stand by. Hopefully in the next couple of weeks we'll be able to release some details and pick a date for sign-ups and give you the official information on everything. But we are working on that for the third annual Ben & Woods Open coming up later, early this summer, hopefully.
Yes, yes, that is the plan. It's going to look a little different, but it's going to be a great time as always.
I know people always ask me, like, anyone who's been at the golf tournament, going to do it again? When's the next one? When's the next one? We are working on it. I promise you that we are working on it. It's not the easiest thing to just put together a golf tournament. I will say that.
Yeah, it's really not at all, and quite involved. And we'll be doing it a little differently, so hopefully you guys enjoy it, and hopefully we can pull it off.
Yep. We have a great second half of the show after a legendary first half today. When we come back, so I guess it's just going to be Jordan, you said?
Yes.
Jordan is going to join us from Cespedes Family BBQ, which is fine. Jake, something came up with Jake. It's tough to manage both of them at the same time, so we'll just begin our alternation of Cespedes Family BBQ guys talking some baseball to kick off our 8 a.m. hour when we come back with Jordan Schusterman of Cespedes Family BBQ. I still have Don't Do This to get to, which normally goes when Jay Mohr was in studio. We got Reindl Report, and then Mike Shildt will be with us at 9 o'clock for our weekly Manager's Report. And Mike at least knows when to drop in the wins. Bob never seemed to, but the Padres have won the last game of every series.
Yes.
The second game against the Dodgers,
makes
the
for good
last
better
game
radio.
Against the Giants, the last game against the Cardinals.
Yep.
Somehow 4-5 feels way better when you finish every series on a high note.
100%.
And get everyone excited for what's coming up next.
That's exactly right.
Timing. It's all about timing. So our timing is still going until 10 o'clock this morning with Ben & Woods on San Diego's number one sports station, 97.3 The Fan.
Halfway home on a Friday. Ben and Woods, 97.3. The Fan, thanks so much for being here. However you choose to consume us, we really appreciate being consumed by you. I am Woodsy. That is Paul Reindl, the executive producer, not the board op. It's offensive from Jay Mohr. Ben Higgins, co-host, friend, lover.
Also not the board op.
Also not the board op.
Mostly because I couldn't do it.
I had to run mine. It was very hard. Very hard.
Like, if I just left right now,
we're
what
done.
Would happen?
We're done for
could
that.
You,
well,
could
I mean,
you
we're on the air at the moment, so
I
we
would
could
leave
just keep,
dead air.
You just
we
have
could
to
keep
go
talking.
10 o'clock?
With no sounds, no commercials, no music, no nothing for, you know, until Braden gets here, which is, you know, 9:58. So.
Hey, you can't just leave.
So we just have to talk. But we could, well, actually, we couldn't even get our next guest on without Paulie's
help. I don't know how to answer the phone. I have no idea how to answer the phone.
So excited to have back this season our friends from Cespedes Family BBQ. Do we have an open for them or anything?
They're just brought to you by Grand Old BBQ.
Brought to you by Grand Old BBQ. And there he is. Jordan is back from Cespedes. Now, Jake's not here. They just had a big earthquake on the East Coast. I hope he's okay. Jordan, have you heard from Jake? Is he all right?
Yeah, no. Jake is unavailable for reasons that have nothing to do with the earthquake that did just happen where he is. I haven't heard from him. I believe he is driving and thus unavailable, but I hope he's okay, because if he isn't, I'm going to look pretty bad being here on this San Diego.
Did you see this? What's 4.7 in Lebanon, New Jersey, just like 50 miles outside of New York City? I bet those skyscrapers were swaying.
That's not standard.
No. We're used to that over here, but not over there. That's unusual for those guys.
I can tell you, as someone who, I mean, now I live in the Midwest, but I have never experienced an earthquake in my life. And this trend will continue. The one I remember happening on the East Coast when I was younger, I was also driving, I guess, far enough away for where I didn't feel it. So I'm still waiting for my first earthquake. In fact, I'm going to get a total eclipse on Monday before I ever get an earthquake.
Are you in the path of totality?
I am right in the middle.
Wow.
I am right there. Wow. So I'm looking forward to Monday very much.
Well, enjoy those tornadoes. They're super fun. I grew up in Texas. It's amazing. Hiding in a bathtub.
Let's listen. This isn't a commentary on the full Midwest experience. I have been in my basement multiple times due to tornado warnings over the last months, but all is well.
It's so good to have you guys back on with us. I love the Friday vibe too. It's just such a more loose show for us every Friday. I mean, I'll be honest with you, we're ready to get the hell out of here on Friday. You know what I mean? Like, but this is fun. You guys will do some of the heavy lifting for us. But it's been an exciting year for you guys. Tell everybody kind of what's going on with you and Jake.
Yeah, no. So I'm curious, by the way, if I'm going to be able to tell the difference between talking to you guys on Friday versus Monday.
I guarantee it.
Or vice versa. Do we come across as any less competent later in the week?
We do. We're professional broadcasters on Monday. We're empty husks by Friday.
Correct.
Great. I can sort of relate to that. But yes, as you sort of alluded to, this has been a really exciting start to the season for Jake and I. We moved over. So, of course, we've been with Fox Sports, writing for Fox Sports over the last few years. But we recently made the move over to Yahoo to start the season. And our podcast also, you know, which was previously at SiriusXM, Baseball Barbercast, now also over Yahoo. So this is the first time in our strange baseball career, whatever that means, that we're all kind of under one roof. Obviously, we're finding ways to do things in as many different places as possible. But for the most part, all of the Jake and Jordan Cespedes BBQ experience now exists at Yahoo. And it's been tremendous so far. We've been really excited about what we've been able to make over there.
It's awesome. Fantastic. Everybody sign up for a Yahoo email address.
I still have mine. I am the only, I have my Yahoo email address.
Yahoo!
They're
keeping us employed.
I'm a brand loyalist. That's what I do. I wanted to start with, you know, it's funny. We've gone 2 hours this morning, and Shohei Ohtani, you know, no stranger to the news these days. You know, a couple of different incidents, I will say. One fairly serious. One, in my opinion, not serious at all. I really enjoyed the Padres fans out there, Padres Twitter, doing an inordinate amount of trolling and S-posting, as we call it here, having fun with the story about Shohei's first home run as a Dodger. But the other story is, I'd say, a pretty big one. And we haven't really heard much of an update on that one, Jordan. Where do you guys kind of fall on everything that's gone on with Shohei and this, I don't know, potential heel turn from Shohei Ohtani?
Sure, yeah, and I agree, and I appreciate, and I recognize the generous interpretation of what has gone on over the last 48 hours in terms of how people have reacted to that story, because I agree with you. I understand trolls going to troll, and that's fine. I'm not going to tell people not to make jokes. Who am I to say that?
Right.
But I do think we should probably tone it down on some of the stuff that's happened over the last couple of days. Now, as for the story, which in some ways has been kind of surprising that we haven't been talking about it, but also I did kind of know that even though it was right, you know, it's the start of the season, this is clearly going to be a very complex and deep investigation involving literal multiple federal agencies involving Mr. Ohtani. And so I think it's going to be really interesting how long this drags out. And I don't think, because it's going to be going on in the background, I'm sure obviously there's certainly going to be people like reporters from ESPN and other investigative units that are going to try and get more out of it. But I really don't think we're going to hear much on this until the next official update, which could come, who knows? I have no way of speculating, but it doesn't make the story any less of a big deal. But maybe I'm naive to say like, who cares? Let's just watch the baseball. Right. But you guys know me, like I kind of just want to watch the baseball.
It's funny, cause I was thinking the other day how quiet everything's been. But we haven't really talked about it in the last few days either. We've gotten our focus back on the field and on the baseball, which is fine. I guess there's just not much more to say until we have more information at this point.
Yeah, because I think what was very clear is what we did get when Shohei finally spoke was a very clear, this is my story. I'm sticking to it. I know there was some confusion early on in the very early stages of this when they were still in Korea, and that's fine. But it's clear. He said, I was a victim. And so we will find out if that is true. But when we find out whether that is true is you know, God knows when. So at this point, you know, I the league obviously has no reason to actually punish him. I'm going to enjoy watching Shohei Ohtani play baseball.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not, because he plays for the Dodgers. But I certainly, you know where I fall on that. Talking to our pal Jordan Schusterman here from Cespedes Family BBQ, brought to you by Grand Old BBQ. And now I want barbecue.
Yeah,
go figure. Once we start talking about it, I know you're a big M's fan as well. I picked them weirdly to win the West. I love their rotation. I know Kirby got lit up the other day, and that's pretty unusual for him. But I look at that team and I go, again, they got the arms. They've got a good manager. They've got a good fan base. They've got a superstar in center field. They've got good, solid players. Do you still feel like, because we're sitting here every day going, we need another piece. Like here in San Diego, we have to get another bat. Where do you stand on your beloved M's?
Yeah, and Kirby definitely wasn't good the other day. However, it was a defensive disaster class,
100%.
As they call it. I mean, these were just like goofy level mistakes that you have seen from teams like the Rockies,
the A's,
and the White Sox, and the A's, but for a team in Seattle that had legitimate aspirations, you know, to push for a postseason spot, if not a division title this year, it has been a sort of embarrassing start to the season from that standpoint. I still think when you have the pitching that they do, that they are still in, the floor is still pretty high.
Yeah.
But man, I mean, I actually think, not to forcibly force this to, you know, switch this to Padres chat, I do think it is interesting because the Mariners, and I did a piece for this for Yahoo, just kind of exploring it, how different teams are and compared to last year. Just not just like, okay, they brought in this guy, like how many players that played for them last year are not in the organization anymore.
Yep.
And the reason why I'm tying these teams together is because the Mariners overhauled their offense. Their offense is more different than any other team in the league compared to last year. And the Padres can say the same thing about the pitching staff. And so while you can see the parallel of both teams spent a lot of time and just a wild sequence of transactions to completely remodel their offense or their pitching staff, in the Padres' case, we're still trying to figure out, is it better? Is it worse? Yeah. Is it like, is it just different? Like, are we still heading towards the same place? You know, we're a week in, so we certainly still need to draw conclusions for any of it. But that's going to be a major theme in these early months of the season. It's just like, what am I looking at? What is this team? Who are these people?
Talking to Jordan Schusterman from Cespedes Family BBQ. And I don't mind you steering us to a little Padres chat. It was a very active offseason. I mean, I don't know that we've ever seen a team slash payroll by nearly $100 million, yet also still think, hey, we're contenders and can go for it. And your reaction to like the Dylan Cease move that happened during spring training and kind of how they've tried to still put together a competitive team while getting under the luxury tax level here.
Yeah, right. So the obvious place to start, as you said, like, how can you trade Juan Soto and say that, you know, our number one goal is to be the best we can be? That's fine. And I still sort of believe that. However, once you accept that they looked at the situation and said, if we are going to literally have enough innings on the field this year, this is the fastest path to building that depth. And then to add to that, by turning that into Cease indirectly, using a piece like Drew Thorpe, is so creative and so aggressive and such an unsurprising sequence when you consider that's just what this Preller front office does. It's a whirlwind. It's a lot to process. Now, unlike the Mariners, who it was kind of more self-imposed in terms of the payroll stuff, I mean, clearly there were payroll considerations with the Padres too, but they also just had an unbelievable, almost unprecedented amount of innings walk out the door in free agency, right? It's a situation that's just how the timelines lined up with the contract, so they had to replace those guys somehow. And they did it in a very creative way, and I know some of them, it's been a mixed bag so far. I'm really high on Dylan Cease still. I love that guy, and I think that he is going to be a really good pitcher for the Padres, and I think that the comparisons to Snell are not unfair. He is pretty much the closest thing you have from a right-handed standpoint. He hasn't been as good for as long. He doesn't have as much of a track record. But the stuff is there, and I expect him to be good, especially if he can stay healthy. But that's one starter. And with the struggles of Musgrove so far and with just how new this bullpen is, I just still have no idea what to expect from this group. You know, I know I'm calling myself number one Stephen Kolek fan here, but I don't know what I'm getting from a Rule 5 pick. So it's kind of hard to say really what to expect.
Do you have any association with Stephen Kolek?
Really only that, again, going back to the Mariners, he had been with the Mariners the last couple of years. And I was like, last year, I was like, why isn't Stephen Kolek in the big leagues?
Yeah, I mean, they're leaning on him too. I mean, yeah, no. Shildt's gone to him a few times and he's yeah. been semi-effective.
You're
at
hoping
times,
that
too.
We have to give him back to the
yeah,
Mariners.
You want
him
back.
In
I
the
mean,
Rule 5.
I know your
yeah.
game. Yeah.
Honestly, with the injuries, it's well, that's maybe why I really think about it. With the injuries they've had to Brash and Santos, I'm like, oh, it could really Stephen Kolek would have been nice to have right now. So again, it's not like I'm expecting him to become a closer or anything, but still, it's just so many of those new. But not to mention, you know, Michael King and some of the signings like, you know, Yuki Matsui and Brito, who I feel like is pitching every time I turn the TV on. They're putting Cosgrove in every game, and that obviously hasn't been going super well so far. So it's just a lot of turnover there, and it just means sometimes that can be a good thing, and sometimes you just don't really know what you're going
to
get.
Well, Jordan, it is good to be have you back in the fold for this season on Fridays, you and Jake, and the chat enjoys the tin caps.
They love the tin caps.
Home of Ethan Salas now.
We like pandering here. I mean, we always pander. Always.
I'm not only will I happily pander with this hat, but I will be going to see the Tin Caps at some point this month, and I'm looking forward to seeing Salas and hopefully Lesko in person.
All right. Well, enjoy your eclipse. Hope the weather holds up for you and you actually get to see it turn dark and then light again. We're not anywhere near the path of totality, but you can give us a report the next time we talk to you.
I will. Looking forward to it, guys. Always good to see you.
Thanks,
there is Jordan Schusterman on our chat with Cespedes Family Barbecues, guys. Every Friday now, brought to you by Grand Hole Barbecue. It is the best, most authentic barbecue in San Diego.
I love it, man.
South so Park, good. Flint Springs, and you can always get it at the ballpark. As
drove
well.
My ass like 40 miles to pick it up on a Sunday. Just no problem. Loved it.
You're a Texas guy.
Phenomenal.
It's the best Texas
brisket.
It's
really, 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 really good.
It is so good.
All right. I need it.
All right. Let's take a time out. We do have some Clapton tickets I want to give away here. They are going on sale this morning at 10 o'clock, but you can still win them before everybody else does. AXS.com is where you get them. But third caller right now, 833-288-0973. Give you a pair of tickets to Eric Clapton at Pechanga Arena on October 8th. 833-288-0973. We'll get to a little Don't Do This. We didn't bring up the Oakland A's yet. Got to do that coming up in Don't Do This next on Ben and Woods after a check of traffic here on 97.3 The Fan. Oh, I hope you're not using our show today to time your morning, because you're very late. If you usually like leave for work when Don't Do This comes
screwed.
On, you are like an hour late right now. Don't Do This is brought to you by the Kraft Taco in Sorrento Valley. The Kraft Taco has some of the best quality tacos in all of San Diego. This would be a good day for the Kraft Taco on Friday. Go to thekrafttaco.com. Take a look at their happy hour specials, thekrafttaco.com. All right, I will start Don't Do This with the announcement came down during our show yesterday. The Oakland A's ending their 56-year tenure in the East Bay by announcing a move temporarily to Sacramento for at least the next three seasons while they build their new ballpark on the Las Vegas Strip. Everyone knows that the A's were once a great team. They had four World Series titles, and now they are abandoning that market for a tiny little, really 10,000-seat stadium that they will share with the Giants' AAA team, the Sacramento River Cats. Now, the Don't Do This for Me goes to, once again, A's owner John Fisher, who held a very quick news conference at Sutter Health Park in Sacramento yesterday. He got up for 1 minute and 45 seconds and then left taking no questions. That's it. You take a team that's been somewhere for 56 years.
Minute 40.
I mean, that's almost as bad as Dean sending a tweet and saying, we're gone to L.A., to San Diego. 1 minute, 45 seconds, no questions. We won't be taking questions at this time. But in that 1:45, he still managed to stick his foot completely in his mouth.
Yeah.
In that 1:45, Paul, you got the audio.
I just want to say we're excited to be here for the next 3 years, playing in this beautiful ballpark, but also being able to watch some of the greatest players in baseball, whether they be athletics players or Aaron Judge and others, launch home runs out of this very intimate, the most intimate ballpark in all of Major League Baseball for the next 3 years.
Such a spin. The intimate. If somebody tells you it's intimate, it's small. How's your wiener?
Undersized.
It's intimate. It might have an intimate wiener. If somebody tells you that, run for the hills. Mine?
Slightly above intimate.
Yeah, it's a little bit above intimate. Yeah. Yeah, it's intimate.
So
if it stays intimate for more than 4 hours, call
your doctor.
What most
not as intimate as I used to be, right?
What most people took issue with was the fact that he kind of randomly generic athletics players, because no one knows any of them,
yeah.
but actually called out Aaron Judge by name. He's really excited to see Aaron Judge come in and take his pitchers deep, go yard off his guys. Maybe Shohei Ohtani come in, hit some bombs out of this intimate little ballpark against my players. Can you ever imagine, God rest his soul, Peter Seidler saying anything like, I'm so excited to see other players.
Mookie Betts coming in here
come in
and just lay in the woods to Petco Park.
Way.
What?
There's no way, because Peter was competitive, first of all, but he also got it, which John Fisher clearly doesn't get being a sports fan. And if you don't get being a sports fan, you shouldn't be allowed to own a team, simple as that.
Yeah, no doubt about it.
It's okay to also be a businessman, but you have to start.
You have to have the love.
By being have love of the game and be a sports fan. And then, you know, be business savvy as well. That's fine. But if you have no interest in really being a fan of the team, you've got to get those owners, whatever sport it is, baseball, basketball, football, you've got to get those owners out of sports. It's not just a normal business. It's not the car wash down the street. It's not a law firm. It's not an accounting office. It's way more than that. And you can't have owners like this in professional sports.
It's the heart of a city a lot of times, right? Like the team. It's
sure
the
is
heartbeat
here.
Of the city for sure. So, yeah, it was just continued to just step all over himself at every chance. I did have some fun yesterday with the Shohei Ohtani news that broke. I guess you would call it news. Sam Blum, who was an Angels reporter, or is an Angels reporter, wrote this story in the Athletic. And I mean, look, Twitter is not real life. It's just not. And I think, you know, we have a lot of Dodger fans that listen. You got to you got to relax a little bit and realize that a lot of people are just messing with you. And they, I enjoyed the Padres tweeting out, Padres fans yesterday tweeting out this story. This fan caught Shohei Ohtani's first home run as a Dodger. Hard feelings ensued. I mean, it's like a juicy headline. And then you read it, and he hit a home run, his first as a Dodger. It goes into the stands and picked up by a woman. Well, she goes by Sugar Tees on Twitter. And she got it. And the original story was, oh, Shohei met her, and she got a couple of signed hats and balls and this and that. And then she wrote back, oh, no, he never met me. Well, then Sam goes on this deep dive on this story and writes another article about it. And then it says that she was pressured into making a quick deal. The Dodgers refused to authenticate everything. And this story blows way out of proportion. My favorite part was watching, like, I just tweeted, wow, that's sociopath behavior. I'm joking. Like, I'm clearly just S-posting the Dodgers. To watch the Dodger fans write these long think PC tweet, it's like, buddy, you spent $1 billion on your team. You got to just lean into the hate a little bit, in my opinion. You have to. This story is really not that big a deal.
It's not big. If there's one thing that I did take out of it, it's the part where, like, through his translator show, he said, oh, I met with the fan,
right.
And then they said he didn't. And I just wonder about the communication level here. And it's a new translator now.
So now they're saying,
are we getting accurate comments
correct.
From Shohei Ohtani?
Rusty translation.
What are we actually getting? And can we, on the more important, you know, issue with Shohei Ohtani, the gambling scandal, are we getting the real story?
Real deal.
Or are we getting kind of a clouded version via translation? And that's always, there's a language barrier that always is an issue, but it continues to pop up where Shohei seemingly says one thing and a translator seemingly says something else again. And that is an issue.
I died, though. I mean, Padre fans, Padres Twitter, you should be on doo-doo this today. I mean, really, like, you guys, on an off day for us, which is always weird and creepy, you guys really rose to the occasion. I thought it was really well done.
Finally, a doo-doo this for a Friday.
DD mega doo-doo.
And I thought this was cool. I did not know about this at all. And it's the kind of sports tradition that I love knowing about, like the Masters Champions Dinner.
Oh, you love that dinner.
Which is coming up on Tuesday. Jon Rahm hosting a Spanish tapas-laden feast at Augusta National. But I did not know that there is also a Final Four luncheon.
I didn't
a similar either. Version as well. And it is only open to coaches who have taken a team, head coaches who have taken a team to the Final Four.
That is
so
kick ass.
For the first time this year, Brian Dutcher gets to go to the luncheon. I think it's today. If it wasn't, it was yesterday. But there's a sports jacket involved. It'll be presented to him at the luncheon. He's going to have Steve Fisher, who, of course, is already in the club after taking Michigan to the Final Four. He will present Dutch with his jacket. Gets to go now every year as one of the exclusive clubs of head coaches
really
who have
cool.
taken a team to the Final Four after the Aztecs run last season. Now, I don't know.
So it's any coach that's ever been to the Final Four?
Any
it's
coach,
not just like last year?
No, it's any
Final
coach.
Four.
Is that you're in the club forever once you've taken a team to the Final Four. So he gets to go to the luncheon, I assume somewhere around State Farm Stadium in Arizona, in Glendale.
I know a place right down the street.
Do you think that's where they're having the luncheon?
My guess would be no. Just a guess would be no.
Can you picture Coach Fisher?
No.
That explicit?
No.
And
or
Dutch?
Or Dutcher. No, I can't.
Hang on. Let's.
Rick
just...
Pitino in there? That I can. He's gone to the final. I can
he's
see that.
He's been to the Final Four.
They're like, Rick, welcome back. 100%.
I'm pulling up the menu here at explicit.
Oh,
right
they
now.
Have one?
I didn't even. Yeah, they've had food.
We
yeah.
didn't eat there.
We did. Well, of course, we didn't eat there, but they could.
Got chips and salsa,
delicious.
Fries, mini corn dogs. For
delicious.
Your
had some yesterday.
I bet Dutch
some...
loves a mini corn dog.
Yep.
Sliders. They have burger bites and Mexican burger bites.
Okay.
They've got Taco Tuesday, Jalapeno Popper Friday. Sinful fries Saturday.
Would you rather eat sinful fries?
Loaded fries with carne asada or pollo.
Ooh.
They got wings, cheese or chicken quesadillas.
I'm going to avoid wings
and some tacos.
Would you Would you rather eat at Explicit or Dave and Buster's?
Explicit. not close.
So congratulations to Dutch for joining the exclusive lunch club.
I want to see the jacket.
Final Four. I do too. I don't know. It doesn't say what color it is here.
I want to see what
wrote about it in his notes.
And I do want to see what they had. Lunch. I don't like the word luncheon.
luncheon.
Just call it a lunch.
Not a luncheon.
I don't like luncheon. It makes it sound, it cheapens it for me.
Cheapens it?
Yeah,
it's supposed
it
to fancify
it's not, and it doesn't for me. I hear luncheon and I think, mid. That's what I think every time.
All right, let's take a time out. We'll come
that
back.
Was Whoa. Don't Do This with Ben and Woods here. On 97.3 The Fan.
We only play that at 7:32, not 8:32. Paulie, come on. You know that. We also do a Reindl Report usually on our 9 o'clock hour, but why not do it early? We're doing some things late, some things early, and then we can clear
this
the stage.
Wild. This is wild.
Clear right. the stage for Mike Shildt and our manager's report at 9 o'clock. It's all coming up here on San Diego's number one sports station, 97.3 The Fan.
Got to do a quick birthday shout-out to two. Actually. So I tweeted it. The Lord of the Meat, our beloved Tier 1 Anthony. Happy birthday to him. He was the guy that dressed as the carving guy for our Christmas and holiday extravaganza.
Do you like hot fudge sundaes?
Came out and literally brought and cooked a rib, like a roast, and carved it up for
ham.
People. A ham. Yep. It was spectacular. And he is...
Happy birthday, Anthony.
We love him so much. He's such a good dude. Perfect, perfect Tier 1. Gives us no trouble. None whatsoever.
He's having a very coveted Tier 1 barbecue birthday party today.
Out in Murrieta, yeah. I believe. And then, of course, happy birthday to the great Jesse Agler. I don't know how old he turns today.
28.
28 years old for... Just one of my favorite people on the planet, Jesse Agler. Happy birthday, buddy. Hopefully you're listening. Probably dealing with your... Oh, no. You're in San Francisco.
He's in San Francisco. But he could be listening on Odyssey app.
Yeah.
You know, baseball season is here. You can catch us all season long, wherever the season takes you, with the Odyssey app. Listen to us react to the biggest moments from throughout the year. Be sure to listen live, local play-by-play for every Padres game. Just download the Odyssey app today and search 97.3 The Fan to get started. Local blackouts apply. Paulie's got some headlines in the Reindl Report ahead of Mike Shildt's Friday visit with us. That's coming up right after this check of traffic on 97.3 The Fan.
From the 97.3 The Fan Traffic Center, here's Kelly Danik.
Got some rain hitting part of the county, guys, so you definitely want to take that into consideration. Give yourself a little extra time and take it extra carefully out there. Looks like they're still trying to get this stalled truck out of the right lane on westbound 52 just past Mast Boulevard. Traveling on northbound 5 near the King Freeway, we have reports of a tire in the fast lane. I'm Kelly Danik with Ben and Woods, San Diego's number one sports station, 97.3 The Fan.
And get things started here with our edition, today's edition of the Reindl Report.
Now tuned into the motherfucking greatest.
Welcome to the Reindl Report with Paul Reindl.
Hi, Paul.
All right.
Two stories from the world of sports that we haven't gotten to yet.
We'll start off in Major League Baseball.
And one story that you didn't know you needed.
Are you laughing, biatch?
It's the Reindl Report.
Hey, Paul, how you doing?
Okay, how are you?
On 97.3 The Fan.
Are you ready to bless the mood? I need some help, please.
That was good.
Can I get a hoy?
All right. Happy Friday, gentlemen.
Oh, happy Friday.
Got a couple of basketball stories here, Woodsy's favorite. I think you can actually contribute to both of these stories.
Maybe.
We'll start. Biggest thing in sports right now is going to be the Final Four.
Yeah.
The women's Final Four takes place tonight. We got two games. Purdue, number one seed, taking on NC State at 3:09 on TBS, and they will be followed by the one seed. Or I'm sorry, that was the men's side.
That's the men's, yeah.
Women's side is 4 o'clock tonight. South Carolina, NC State, 1-3. And then the one seed Iowa taking on number 3 seeded UConn. And then on the men's side tomorrow, we will have Purdue and NC State, UConn versus Alabama. And I'm looking at the lines. If you just look at the lines, there's only going to be one good game.
Yeah.
And that would be on the women's side. Iowa is favored over number 3 UConn by 2.5 points. The other women's game, South Carolina, favored by 11.5.
Oof.
And then tomorrow on the men's side, Purdue is favored by 9.5, and UConn is favored by 11.5.
Stayed at 11.5, huh?
It has not moved.
I was
shocked.
Wow.
They haven't won by less than 15, I think, every game in the tournament. And I thought, man, almost double digits for 3 out of the 4 Final Four games between both the men's and the women's side. I go, does that ever happen? Like, they're predicting blowouts.
Yeah, by the time you get to the Final Four, it should only be good teams, so
yeah,
you usually expect
close
points.
Games.
Right. Now, on the men's side, we kind of knew at the beginning, everyone was saying, we think UConn and Purdue and maybe Houston are kind of a step above everybody else. Now, Houston had the injury to Shed, and they got knocked out in a close game, but Purdue and UConn have pretty much dominated. I'd be disappointed at this point if we didn't get a UConn-Purdue final. If anyone can give UConn a game, it would be Zach Edey having a big night for Purdue. It's the game I want to see on Monday night.
What
so.
Would you project that line to be at, though? Does it depend on
I
how
think
well both teams play?
That's a good
play?
Question. Probably a little bit.
Like,
but
I'd guess UConn like 6.5.
That's exactly what I was going to say. 6.5 for UConn if it ends up UConn-Purdue. On the women's side... Yeah, South Carolina is a huge favorite. They never lose. Never. lose. I don't know when the last time they lost was. It's like 3 years ago or something. North Carolina State's a big underdog. They're just kind of happy to be there, looking to pull off the upset. The other game, though, is the game. It's Caitlin Clark, Paige Beckers. It's the one that it could be very competitive, very exciting. The last Caitlin Clark game was really good, lived up to the hype. They pulled it out. They got to the Final Four. The ratings for that last one, the most watched women's game in the history of college basketball. Tonight could be something similar as well, especially it's the second game on ESPN at 6 o'clock with UConn, the traditional power of the Huskies against Iowa, the greatest player maybe we've seen in college basketball, women's history. Going to be a lot of attention on that one. We'll see if it lives up to the hype again tonight.
Yeah, LeBron James was quoted earlier in the week saying the power in the women's game is unbelievable.
I heard that quote.
Even more than some of the men.
Sure.
Like, it's really cool what they've built up, especially in women's college basketball. But speaking of LeBron, his son, in the news, the second story today was going to be about the USC Trojans taking on Eric Musselman.
The Musk bus is coming to Los Angeles, and Woods is not happy about it.
No, I mean, if you're a USC fan, you're elated. He's a really good coach. And when they signed Lincoln Riley, I was like, so?
How's that going to work?
I was like, so?
So far, you've been proven somewhat.
Couldn't
right.
win a big game with a gun to his head. Really?
For USC so far.
Honestly, when they signed him, I was like, all right, BFD, right? When this came out this morning, I was like, damn it. I like Musselman a lot.
That story has now turned into the Bronny James story from USC because Bronny James announced officially, it's kind of been rumored for a while now, that he will enter the 2024 NBA draft and still going to maintain college eligibility, but he will be entering the transfer portal. He announced that this morning on his Instagram account.
So that's to basically say, I don't want to play.
I'm keeping my options open.
I want to find out where I might be taken in the draft, and I can always go back to school, but I'm not going to be at USC.
You can actually even go
back. He could go
back
to USC.
You can do whatever you want. Same thing with great Osabor. He's thinking draft. He's transfer portal. He also says, but I might go back to Utah State as well. You can keep all. You might as well. I mean, unless you're 100% sure you want to go back to your school, might as well enter the transfer portal at this point in college basketball. I mean, most
is it to wait on offers to see? Like,
yeah, pretty
like
much.
I asked you this morning, Great Osabor, what a player! Like
he'd do
really well here on the Mesa. Like he would be a very nice addition to Brian Dutcher's team. Do they have? I guess now we're asking the question: can they afford Great Osabor at this point? And or is he going to go make money in the NBA? So you wonder what Dutch and his crew. How much energy do you want to expend on guys like that?
I'm sure they are looking just under every rock for every transfer. I don't think Dutch, he doesn't really want to have a guy that's making 20 times what the other guys on his team are making in NIL. You know, they've finally realized, we got a little more money for everybody, and we probably have to pay the starters and stars a little bit more. But he's not looking, Keyshawn Johnson, who was in the college slam dunk contest last night, went for reportedly $400,000 to Arizona for his last year. And they're not going to be able to match figures like that.
Yeah.
If that's what a guy like Great Osabor is looking for, then he's not coming to San Diego State.
It could be more than that, I would imagine.
It could be more than that.
Yeah. Okay.
The Bronny James angle is interesting to me because that's one, I don't think next year will be LeBron's final year.
Right.
I'm talking about Daddy LeBron. I don't think that's going to be his final year. He probably got two or three more years, and he wants to play with his son. And it'd be unfair to say that Bronny James just had a bad year. He had a heart defect that kept him on.
It's true.
He was off the court for like 6 months.
The average 4.8
wasn't great.
2.8
statistically.
2.1. Yeah,
those are not numbers that get you drafted. When your dad's LeBron James, and you have the prospect of if you're the Hornets and you draft Bronny James, knowing we'll probably be getting LeBron.
Is that true? I mean, really? Like, is he?
Yes.
LeBron will fully walk away and go sign with whoever drafts his kid.
What else does he have to do?
And if you're Jeannie Buss, who we had her husband in earlier, Jay Moore, is she like, all right,
got to draft him?
Got to do it.
And you're almost wasting. I don't want to say wasting, but you're kind of wasting a draft pick, right?
Got to do it.
Kind of, yeah.
Because you're any other team, again, you think you have a chance at getting LeBron, even if it's at age 41. Yeah. You're getting the jersey sales, the seats, marketing, yep. Okay, the ticket sales.
I will it's fully, worth it. Fully. Bronny has not shown enough to like earn a first round draft pick status. He still, however, has those genes, has a great mentor,
yeah.
And could end up being a really good player. It's not like he doesn't know basketball or anything. He had a heart attack a year ago and didn't really get to play as much as he wanted right. This year. So
Brett makes a good point in the chat. He says it would be weird to have to share a shower with your son at that age, in my opinion.
I didn't think about that.
I didn't think about that angle, but wow. After game, after practice.
Yeah.
All right, let's go shower. Hey Dad, I'm gonna go over here in this corner.
I had never even thought about that.
Brett, I like where your head's at.
Did like Ken Griffey Jr. and Ken Griffey Sr.
Yes.
Yeah. Shower together with the Reds?
I'm going first. I'm the old guy. You go get me a beer, and I'll be out, and then you will switch.
It's great.
I didn't think about that. I like, he's thinking about all the options and all the angles. And I appreciate that, Brett, very much.
Finally, a bit of an update to a story from a little while back. Kiss, the band.
Beloved.
Your beloved. They have a reputation, not just for melting faces, but they like to sell pretty much anything Kiss memorabilia-wise that they can get their hands on.
Caskets. they have a Kiss casket. If I was going to be buried, and I don't want to be, I want to be cremated. Maybe my wife could get me a Kiss urn. I'm sure they have them.
I'm sure they do.
Huh.
Sure they do. Now, Kiss has sold just about everything,
yeah.
And now, well, they've sold themselves.
Sold their souls.
Kiss has sold Kiss for $300 million.
Oh, my God.
Their music catalog, their name, the logo, image and likeness, everything. They have sold Kiss as an entity to a company that is called Pop House Entertainment.
Okay.
And we talked about this a while ago. There was a report that Kiss had finished playing live, they were done touring, and they were going to live on in hologram form.
So I heard
do concerts in hologram form.
I heard the hologram thing, and then I heard, what about Kiss just goes on, but with different people? So Paul Stanley, Gene Simmons, Tommy Thayer, and whoever, I think
Eric
Singer.
There are a lot of bands that have replaced everybody at a certain point, and then they keep touring. But like
everybody,
someone of the original band has to remain for the band to exist still. Or
I mean, I don't like it necessarily when it's like, oh, we're the bass. I'm the bass player from the original Grand Funk Railroad. It's just me left. But like with Kiss, who's going to replace Paul? Who's going to do his banter? We listened to some recently. I heard you like to drink vodka and orange juice. It's the I like cold gin. It's my favorite thing. So now some guy is like, I'm auditioning for the role of Paul Stanley, but I'm going to actually go play concerts. It's not cool.
I don't know about that, but they are definitely going to be doing like hologram concerts and tours.
And that's what the company is going to do. That
the
bought
company,
their rights.
They've been
can
doing
do
it
whatever
with,
they want.
They've been doing Avatar shows whatever. And so they
300 mil.
What prevents Kiss. Now Kiss though? Because they're still alive, right?
Yeah.
What prevents them from now just, you know, re-recording everything like Kiss Taylor's version? And just having their own catalog again.
Count on it.
I mean, they could. Gene Simmons was quoted saying, Kiss, the touring band is over. What Pop House will do with our images, our music, and our personas is unlike anything anyone has ever seen. Still a ways away. These shows are not scheduled to start up until 2027.
Well, it's a good indication.
They're also working on a biopic and a documentary on Kiss.
All in.
Does anyone want to buy
That's what
Men
I was
going to
say.
Woods
what are we
Paul?
Worth? The whole package.
Well, probably not 300 million, but.
Probably like 300 pennies.
$300. I bet we get $3,000. I'm taking my buyout. My $1,000 just walking away. I'll take the buyout.
Split it up. Chop it up.
Yeah,
we'll live on forever in hologram form.
I'll take the G and just walk right now. That's pretty cool, man.
I saw, though.
$97.30.
Yeah.
I follow up though on a similar. I think you did the Reindl Report story about the AI George Carlin. Remember that?
Yes, that was very weird.
So they had a lawsuit. They just settled. The company that put out that
the
George Carlin's estate sued, and they settled recently. And basically, the settlement was: we will never play the George Carlin again. We will never do anything George Carlin related ever again. And pretty much, I think they just like walked away. So, I mean, the precedent's kind of been set. You can't just, you just can't go in and fake AI people and then start like selling that.
Yeah. Listen to clips of that. Hearing George Carlin like commentating on Taylor Swift's relationships and like Donald Trump
weird,
and Joe Biden, like it was
very strange.
But, you know, maybe they have AI Paul Stanley can riff at new concerts.
You got manager interviews coming up next. Mike Shildt. I said Mike Shildt. Place goes nuts. Nuts.
Should go nuts.
Yeah.
Mike Shildt is worthy of a Paul Stanley introduction. And it is a Friar Friday, which means the manager's report is coming up next. We will speak with Mike Shildt live from San Francisco. I don't know if he's at the probably at the ballpark by now since it's an early game.
Yeah, early game.
1:35 today.
Give me the lineup on the air live.
Probably get some early insight into today's matchup against the San Francisco Giants. So we'll chat with Mike Shildt coming up and get you ready for game one. True road game. Technically, they played one road game in Korea and one home game, but the first true road game of the season against Bob Melvin's San Francisco Giants coming up later today here on 97.3 The Fan. Sammy Levitt's Eco Water SoCal pregame show beginning at 12:35 today here on 97.3 The Fan. So day baseball. Mike Shildt coming up next. Final hour of Ben and Woods on the way on San Diego's number one sports station, 97.3 The Fan. I just have no doubt that an off day sits better when you're coming off a win.
Oh, yeah. No question.
I mean, you could take a series, take two out of three. Yeah. If you lose the last one,
sucks.
You're not going to be able to enjoy the off day as much. So hopefully the Padres were able to enjoy the day off. It was actually a travel day yesterday because Tony Gwynn came in to studio for the roundtable, then headed down to Petco Park, and they got on the plane and went to San Francisco yesterday. And joining us right now on a Friar Friday, it's time for the Manager's Report with Padres manager Mike Shildt, brought to you by San Diego County Credit Union. It's not big bank banking. It is better, and probably already at Oracle Park for the early game. Mike, it is good to have you back on. Ben and Woods.
Yeah, good to see you guys. Yeah, at the ballpark, ready to get after it.
All right, give us a lineup then. Nobody ever breaks news on this show, Skip, ever. It never happens.
Same first six as always? I mean.
I think you're safe there.
Yeah, all right. That's all. You know what? I actually wanted to start there because we talked a little bit about it before, the consistency of that top six. I mean, obviously, you like what you've put together there to get your team started every day, first inning, maybe second inning. Hopefully, you know, you get as many of those guys up in the first inning as possible.
Yeah, that's right. I do like the construction, clearly. Been riding with it for a while. Feel like it's working. You know, there's some methodology to it that, you know, again, lineups are, you know, can be fluid. But, you know, we've been in this season now and not so deep to where guys are getting days off, which obviously would affect the lineup. But just makes a lot of sense. The bottom of the lineup's done a nice job as well, turning over for those guys.
They really have, and I wanted to ask you about that too. It's one of the, you know, it's nice. You got your first six, and then you can kind of move around, you know, depending on, you know, if Campy needs a day off or you want to get Sugar going against a lefty or whatever it is. But how are you kind of doing that right now with Jackson Merrill is one. You know, everyone wants to see that kid in the lineup every day. How hard is it to kind of temper his enthusiasm, your enthusiasm to see him play? Because he's really done a nice job so far.
He's done a great job. I mean, yeah, he's been in there every game. You know, he hasn't started all but two. Like you mentioned, it's important, you know, like with Higgy the other day, to get him in there. And, you know, we need to keep guys, you know, are usually coming off the bench, and to keep them fresh, keep them engaged. We do have a 26-man roster. Want to be smart about using it. Allow those guys to participate as well, feel involved, and, you know, they're big league players. But, yeah, always good to see Jackson play. I love watching him play. He's done a great job. Also want to be mindful of, you know, the fact it's going to be his first full season in the big leagues, and it's a long year. And, you know, so you play the short game, and you also have to play the long game a little bit.
Talking to Mike Shildt here on 97.3 The Fan. It's our manager's report brought to you by SDCCU. And I didn't realize there was a term for this, but the Padres are playing a semi-repeater, they call it. When you face one team and then you have a series and then you go back and face the same team again. And like tonight, you get the exact same pitching matchup, Mike, as you did on Saturday. Does that change anything as a skipper when you've just faced a team and you have the same matchups again? And do you want to do things a little bit differently? It's not football, obviously. You're not changing the playbook. But how does that impact a series when you've just faced the same team a few days ago?
Yeah, I've never heard the term either. It's a new one. I think it's taking place more, it feels like, in the league for whatever reason, from a scheduling standpoint. Doesn't bother me either way. You know, relative to changing anything, you know, the one thing that historically you would say, the more looks that hitters get at pitchers, the more advantage it typically is for the hitter, as the game goes. And then, you know, as we you know, are seeing Jordan, you know, for the second time in less than a week. So, you know, we'll evaluate and see. But, you know, we clearly know what he's going to do. And now we just got to make sure we're ready to compete against him.
I think that's the thing, talking to Mike Shildt here on Ben and Woods, that makes it so hard sometimes because, yeah, he's seen you and thrown really well against you. Now he knows that he threw really well against you, and he may change his game plan. I mean, the chess and the overthinking that can go into it, I would be enough to keep me up 24 hours a day, every day, Skip, just thinking about, like, oh, is he going to change his game plan on you guys after a really nice performance?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's about anything in this league. It's about consistency of what you're doing. There is a little bit of the I'm trying to think of the correct word, strategy, you know, mentality, or, you know, how you want to execute, because, you know, it's clearly a league that has all the resources to be able to evaluate on metrics, on analytics, on the eye test, on the competition. So now it's like, oh, well, you know, you did well. Do you change it up? You stay with your strengths. Do you go against your, you know, your strengths to get their strengths? Do you go against, you know, your weakness against their weakness? You know, it's just, you land on a lot of different places. The ultimate is execution. You know, I don't think it's going to be a real big secret that George is going to throw a lot of sinkers, sliders, and splits. You know, he showed the ability to throw a split later in the count, which was a little surprising, and execute it. You know, if a guy's got three good weapons, that's throwing 96 and 99 with good sinker, they can also hit with a split finger in the 2-2 or 3-2 count and, you know, throw what he wants to. That's going to be tough to battle, but we'll battle it. If he can't, it gets easier on our side. So it really just gets down to execution of what your best weapons are against the team that you're competing against and see where it stacks up.
You know, it's funny. I feel like the word you were looking for was approach, which is the word that a lot of fans, myself included, go, oh, I liked their approach last night. They scored 7 runs. You know, and
I was thinking like going against tendencies tendencies.
But when you hear the word approach, it's very general, you know, and could you as the skipper explain, you know, so far so good for Victor Rodriguez and as the hitting coach, and you know, you're seeing some guys really thrive right now, guys like Campusano, guys like Crony, looking great early part of the season. What has he brought, number one, and what is kind of his philosophy and I guess approach?
Well, I'll just unpack the approach in general. I think it's a great opportunity to explain some things about approach. You know, approach, intent, plan, whatever those words you want to use, you know, they can be buzzwords, but without them, you don't have a plan, you don't have an approach, you really don't have anything, you don't have an identity, you're not really going to stand for anything. So starts with having one, then the next chapter of that is having the right one, and then beyond that, being able to change it relative to what you see in competition. And then you know, it gets to be about execution. So, you know, you think about an approach, offensive approach, you know, clearly we're going to have an approach to how we're going to do everything, how we're going to pitch guys, how we're going to defend guys, sure, how we're going to base run against guys, et cetera. But now again, it gets to be about, is there intent to what that looks like? And the thing that I've been really, really, really pleased about, and now we'll segue into the offensive side of it, is, you know, the clarity of what we're trying to accomplish with our approach from an offensive standpoint relative to our strengths and relative to what we're going to see and our ability to adjust as the game goes. We talk about being better as the game goes. Been really pleased with that. Now, people hear that and say, well, you know, you didn't execute some days. Well, I can tell you this game is stinking hard. Mm-hmm. And there's no excuse to that. I'm not an excuse maker, but I'm also a realist. And there's times where, you know, we don't get it done or we do get it done. But if we don't, I didn't have a plan, have an approach. And there are times where you'd be right. It didn't. We maybe had one but didn't focus enough to really execute it or have the right intent to execute it. But I can tell you we've had the right intent to execute. And when you have the right intent, that's all you could ultimately ask for. You know, the physical ability and execution, you know, is usually gives you your best opportunity. Relative to Victor, that's what he brings. He brings a real simplicity that also, I think, has genius to it in its simplicity and a consistency, not, you know, just doing the same thing over and over, but doing it, making sure we stand for something with our offense, how we're going to compete, how we're going to get back to something if we get away from it. And it's really about just having a good at bat, using the whole field, being aware of what he's throwing, and then being able to go about and having a good quality at bat. And then when the game starts and the player, you know, the guy facing us is not doubling up on his fastball or, you know, doesn't have a certain pitch or has a pitch that we weren't expecting, are throwing in more than we were expecting. There's a conversation about it amongst the group, and there's an adjustment, and you know, that's all you can ask, and that gives you the best chance for success. And Victor's done a tremendous job, knew he would, and really glad to have him on the staff.
Mike, how's Manny doing? I know you'd probably tell everybody, not the best at-bats the last couple of games. He's still on pace for like 40 homers and over 100 runs batted in. But in terms of the rehab and, you know, getting back to third base soon, just how's he progressing in your eyes?
Yeah, I'm glad you said about the 40 homers, 100 RBIs. You know, we talked about the long game earlier in our interview today. And, you know, you look up and you have a couple games that, you know, balls don't fall or, you know, see a guy as well, and it's like, oh my gosh, you know. But he is on pace for 40 homers and 100 plus RBIs, which would probably put him in the top 10, 5 in MVP voting. Relative to his throwing, he threw the other day, he's a little bit ahead of schedule. I don't want to create too much buzz about it, but he is, you know, in a good place relative to his arm. He's still got a way to go, but he threw to, you know, he's been playing catch, been extending out his distance in his catch, and, you know, on Wednesday he was taking ground balls and getting feet to second base, which is encouraging, and sounds like he came out of it, you know, feeling good. So, you know, we're still a couple weeks away from, you know, getting any serious consideration about him being on the field, but he's making strides.
Talking to the skipper, Mike Shildt, here on Ben and Woods this morning, and I always say it, and I will always have your back on it, because I think it's the hardest thing to do in professional sports, other than actually hitting a baseball, is managing a bullpen. It speeds up really fast. You know, you throw Wandy Peralta in there the other day, you're not expecting him to hit the first two guys. And, you know, it's like, oh, boy, all right, I got to get.
I did that in Little League.
Dude, you got to get somebody hot. And you got to get somebody hot quick. It's a slow game, but it speeds up for, you know, it's got to. It's got to speed up on you. Nobody's expecting that from Wandy. For you, what are you wanting to see more out of your bullpen right now?
Yeah, you know, you're right. I mean, a big part of your job is running the bullpen. You're always got contingency plans. You know, you always are expecting it to work, but you're preparing for it in case it doesn't. So, you know, the other day it didn't, you know, didn't work for Wandy to get going. And so we had, you know, we had Suarez ready and to back him up. You know, once we see what's taking place in front of us, you know, you got the three batter minimum. So, you know, there's different kind of strategy, not as much of as there used to be where, you know, you could kind of go hitter to hitter and at least start with a guy. But anyway.
Do you like, you know, that rule, by the way, or do you hate the rule?
He does not like that rule.
Well, it makes it a little bit easier on him. You know what I mean? Like if you can pull the trigger quicker if you need to.
I've met a manager who likes that rule.
I know.
We just lost Shildt.
Oh, did we?
Oh, no.
Oh, crap.
He didn't like that question.
I like that question.
Bad question.
Bad Woods.
I was just going to say to him, there's no manager can manage a bullpen well. If the bullpen is performing well, it's because you have good relievers in your bullpen and they're getting the job done. If the bullpen doesn't perform well, it's usually because the manager is misusing them and putting them in the wrong situations. It really is the no-win situation for any skipper, which is
I would hate it.
We got Mike Shildt back. I was just saying, Mike, that managing the bullpen is a no-win situation. When you guys get the job done, it's because you got good relievers out there and they're getting the job done. When they don't, it's because, well, you're an idiot and you put them in the wrong situation.
Exactly.
So there's no way for the manager to win on managing a bullpen.
You guys there?
Yeah, we got you back.
Yeah, so you basically just told me I got no way to win.
Yeah, pretty
exactly.
much.
Yeah, pretty much.
Okay, that's good.
Yep.
But your players can, so that's good.
Yeah, no, that's right. That's a gig. You know, bullpens are, you know, sometimes, like you say, you're only as smart as your bullpen. You know, basically what you do is you put them in the right position. You know, don't like the three-batter minimum rule. It's a rule. Major League Baseball enforces it. I got to abide by it. Do I love it? No, because I don't think it allows you to manage as aggressively as you can, but it's just another different way of using strategy. You know, ultimately what you want out of your bullpen is, and I like our bullpen. I don't want to mistake that. I like our guys, I like our group, and, you know, ultimately what you want guys to go out and be aggressive and trust their stuff and live in the strike zone and allow their defense to work for them and control counts and control the running game.
He learned under Tony La Russa, remember?
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
The guy who he probably would have quit once the three batter minimum rule came in.
Yeah, Tony. I talked played phone tag with him yesterday about a few things, but I didn't get a chance to talk to him. He, you know, he's one of the modern, you know, guys that, you know, well, did a lot of things, but especially with the bullpen was, you know, was ahead of his time.
All right. Well, before you go, I'm just curious. What's a – now, you did the Korea trip. That was atypical. What's kind of a typical road trip like for Mike Shildt? What do you do, like hotel, mornings? How do you spend your time when you're on the road?
Still haven't gotten to a, you know, more of a traditional road trip because it's our first one stateside, and, you know, you don't typically show up for a day game first day of a road trip.
Yeah.
So it's a little different. I'm a night owl typically. I'll read, you know, after games. And, of course, you always, you know, thinking about the next day a little bit, but try to separate the business and the personal. But I'll get up, and I've gotten, you know, stay at some nice properties that typically have, like, a steam or sauna. So I like to go in there and just kind of decompress and grab a little breakfast maybe and head to the ballpark.
I love it.
Well, I'm sure you got a scrum to get to, so say hi to, you know, Lynn and AC and all those guys up there, and hopefully get a win today in the series. Spoil their opening day for us, would you?
Oh, yeah, the best.
That's why we're showing up.
That's
yeah.
It.
Thank all right.
You. Appreciate
Thanks,
it.
Skip. We'll talk to you next week.
Hi, guys.
All right, Mike Shildt, manager of the San Diego Padres, brought to you by San Diego County Credit Union. It's not big bank banking. It's better.
He's going to leave you in the dust.
That was quick. I thought he was kind of falling behind, and then all of a sudden it's just bang, bang, bang.
It's just three jabs right to the throat. Incredible.
All the likes.
That was awesome. He's great.
He's a night owl, too.
Yeah. I'm not. The opposite.
Not anymore.
No, not anymore.
And once upon a time, Woods was a major night
major.
Owl.
Yeah.
I like our guys. Like.
yes.
You're going to have to cut those tight. There,
I like our guys. I like our group. And
let's can we combo that before the end of the show again?
Again.
Yeah, again. I just want to do it every time.
See what I can do.
All right, thank you, Paulie.
All right, we're going to react to what
First,
we just heard from
Tom Petty.
Mike Shildt. We'll give away one more pair of Eric Clapton tickets and give you some of our thoughts on today's game. All coming up with Ben and Woods. Do not go anywhere. Oh, and we'll tell you when we come back. On San Diego's number one sports station, traffic next on 97.3 The Fan. Thanks again to Mike Shildt, our weekly manager's report. Fantastic. He is such, he's so good at explaining
Shildt's
baseball. Yeah, Shildt explaining baseball. It reminds me of when we were at fantasy camp and talking to some of those legends. He would be epic at fantasy camp. I don't know if it fits in his schedule, but Mike Shildt just kind of spending some time with the campers and sharing his insight and his knowledge would be amazing.
Somebody said in the chat, it sounds like this dude would be happy to talk baseball 24/7. And I go, I get that exact same feel. And I love that. I can't get enough of that. He would be rad out there. If they could bring him out to camp in January and have him out there.
Hey, I know you're going to be out here in 2 weeks for
just come on out
spring
early.
Training. Come on out a few weeks early.
Coach us up. Yeah. I think it'd be so great. Yeah.
So I was talking to a couple of our friends with the Padres earlier in the week. Fantasy camp is already looking pristine
looking
in 2025.
Good.
They are expanding. We're going to have eight teams, dude. Remember the first year we went, 2019, January 2019, we had two teams. You were on one team, I was on the other.
Yep.
We played each other every single day. Guess who played in the championship game? Mm-hmm. Both of us.
We both did.
It's getting harder to get to that championship.
It's getting way harder to get.
Eight teams going to be in 2025, and all I remember was, they haven't announced like who specifically will be there from the alumni point of view. I know Mark Grant has been there every single year.
Yep.
Mark Loretta goes every year.
Jake Time
Peavy
of our lives.
Told us in a video that we put out on YouTube after this year's camp, he said, Fantasy Camp 2025, Jake Peavy will be there.
I love it.
He had so much fun.
I saw that even though they've added so many spots, they only have a handful available.
Everybody returns. You go once.
Yeah.
That's so.
And you, like, the day you leave, they have the banquet on Friday night, dinner, awards ceremony, and all that. People re-up that night
the
next year.
Yeah, pay their deposit
night. I'm surprised because I went for the first time, and, it's not – it's not cheap to go to fantasy camp, but every single person there always goes, "Oh no, I'm coming back."
Oh, yeah.
And
just part of the budget now.
And they basically say, "Oh no, I just put it off a little bit each month."
Yep.
It's like just having like one payment. And you can actually sign up right now for fantasy camp by emailing fantasycamp@padres.com to get more information and find out the details for fantasy camp 2025. Reserve your spot, one of the last spots already. I mean, we're talking January of next year.
So elite,
that's how
man.
Fast this fills up. So if you were even thinking about it, at least send off that email and find out, kind of what some of the details are here.
Yeah, don't eat Tim Flannery's cookies. Just don't. That's just my number one recommendation. Stay away. And start your training now. Start running. Start throwing. Like, it's nothing worse than the camper that pulls the hammy on day one, right? So it's the most fun that you'll ever have. If you love baseball, and I'm assuming you do if you listen to this show, it's the most fun you will ever have.
It's been
just so elite fun
seeing it grow.
Yeah.
And the same guys, like we've just said, they come back every year.
Yep.
It's a little camaraderie, a little brotherhood.
It's awesome.
You get to see the same guys every year and then welcome the new guys, the rookies.
Ben will be there again with us, explicit.
Oh, yeah.
And the whole thing. We have a whole tradition now.
And I don't know if this is the selling point for anyone, but the proceeds for Fantasy Camp do benefit the Padres Foundation.
Yep.
Every dime, which
means, I think they said, over half of the cost is actually tax write-off.
Yep.
If you're good at accounting and want to go that way as well, you can sort of justify it to whoever you have to justify it to that you're going. Oh, don't worry. It's a tax write-off. Have you ever tried that with Hannah? She knows more about finances than you do, probably. So don't worry. No, no, Hannah. It's a tax write-off.
I say it all the time. I just write it off.
Yeah,
as far as you know.
Whatever that means.
Yeah.
And it's fun, man. Like, we can tell you everything that we know that happens, but there's always surprises.
Always.
Like,
nobody was
expecting Goose Gossage to
nobody
show up.
Nobody was expecting me to get traded this year.
Sorry, your performance.
First ever trade at fantasy camp.
Yeah, ever trade.
You and Terry Kennedy
didn't vibe, dude.
It wasn't a good fit.
How does one vibe with Terry Kennedy? Sorry, Maggie, but I mean, he's tough. He's tough.
He cut me from the Surf Dogs.
Yeah, he did.
He's tough.
That was
TK can be tough.
Yeah, it was a bit. It was a good bit.
So was the trade, by the way.
Yeah, it was tough. I think his team finished dead last, so no big deal.
No, we won.
Oh, did you?
We got fifth place out of six.
Fifth place.
We won the last place game.
Yeah, the dip-ass game. Yes, exactly.
The 7 a.m. Yeah. Nobody's there. It's freezing cold.
Our entire show on Friday to go play in.
Yeah, that one. That one.
Elite time. Just so good. So good.
Played in the first two championship games. Haven't been back.
I want to talk about Shilties. spot. I thought he did a great job. I could listen to him talk, hitting, approach, all that, all day. I really could. I'm such a nerd for it. And you're already hearing, you're seeing, and I heard Tony Gwynn Jr. talking about it on the roundtable yesterday, talking about the Victor Rodriguez impact so far on this team. And, you know, usually I was looking at offensive rankings too, Ben, for the Padres, and they're kind of near the top for offensive rankings right now. I know it doesn't feel that way. It doesn't. And I don't know, is it because of the blowout game here or there, the obviously the huge game against the Dodgers with all those runs? You know, listen, so far so good, I think, and with room for improvement, certainly. But you're seeing guys like Tatis has changed a lot. Camposano obviously has, and Cronenworth. Those guys really jump off the page to me. Xander, I know, is not hitting for power, but he's dumping the ball in there. He's getting on base. It's been an interesting run, and I'm interested to see how they – how they progress.
Well, it's the stat, and we talked about it, that is such a difference is the contact rate.
Yeah.
That the Padres are striking out less than almost every other team in baseball. They're putting the ball in play. Now, that's not the be-all, end-all to being successful. Teams that put the ball into play also can hit into a lot of double plays, and if you're not making good contact, it's only marginally beneficial to put the ball into play. However, nothing good happens when you strike out. And we've seen Camposano bloop a couple in there. We've seen Xander. I think he has the most soft hits in baseball so far this year.
Yeah.
He's not hitting the ball hard, but you put it in play and you can make some good things happen. Some chaos can ensue once the ball, it's an old school kind of take, that's Tim Flannery-esque kind of take, but you put the ball into play, you force the other team to make a play and do something to get you out.
Tony said it yesterday. It's Petco ball. You know, you have to play to your ballpark in at least the first few months of the season here. And I thought that was a really good point as well. And that's what they're doing right now. So, you know, listen, you got to keep it going. You got to keep it going on the road. Jordan Hicks is nasty. Got a look at him last week. I hope they can make the necessary adjustments and take it to him today. I would love to spoil their home opener. Love it.
Can I just thank SDCCU again,
yes,
for sponsoring that segment, because without them, I don't know that we get Shildt every week.
Correct.
And I love the idea having him every week. You can let him go off on a 3-minute rant about intent versus approach and all that. You don't have to just slam him with hard questions, because we only talk to him every 6 weeks.
Yeah.
And we're going back to that series from a week and a half ago. And
no, it's so good.
Like, it's just, it keeps it a lot more casual. And I think that's such a better listen for the listeners.
Yeah, I'm not panicked about getting my entire list
100%
of questions
right
in, knowing we're going to get another chance to talk to him next Friday.
It's so different.
After another series of games. But yeah, the insight about, just the strategies, Wandy Peralta, the bullpen usage, all of that is...
it's riveting to me.
It is very fascinating.
Yep.
All right, we got one last timeout. We will come back, talk a little bit more about today's game. I saw a request for flubs, but I mean, we just got more likes from Mike Shildt.
I know.
I feel like we're really on a good roll with the likes here at the end of the show. Maybe we put out a poll or something to see which you prefer out there to wrap up our show on a Friday. But we'll get to one of the two when we come back with Ben and Woods on San Diego's number one sports station, 97.3 The Fan. All right. In 20 minutes, those Clapton tickets go on for sale, and I've been promised to give away one more pair. So let's do it right now. Before we get to our traffic report, if you'd like to win tickets to see Eric Clapton at Pechanga Arena on October 8th, last time before they go on sale at AXS.com at 10 a.m., call now 833-288-0973. Lucky third caller going to win our last pair of tickets to Eric Clapton at Pechanga Arena, 833-288-0973. Now, Pechanga, they've already talked about replacing it with the Midway Project, Midway Rising. Saw yesterday that they announced that Viejas Arena may be undergoing some major renovations as well. SDSU is looking into what they can do to upgrade the fan experience. Hey, you've got a power basketball program now. And
strike while the iron's hot.
Viejas Arena was great, and still is.
It's
but
awesome.
When it was opened, which is now, I think it was 1999 when Viejas Arena opened, when Steve Fisher first arrived, it's still in good shape, but it doesn't have a lot in the way of like luxury boxes because you need those big boosters now to help fund your NIL and your program. And big boosters generally like nice things like suites and some VIP areas, and they haven't necessarily done that. They could probably upgrade the concourses a little bit and the food options. So the Associated Students and San Diego State are going to do some like questionnaires and studying and find out what they can do first of all, and then perhaps implement a plan to renovate Viejas Arena to go with their new Snapdragon Stadium.
Yeah, it's going to be weird if they get rid of my beloved Pechanga Arena, San Diego. It needs it. I mean, you need an upgrade down there. I got a Seals game tonight.
That's right.
Against Panther City.
This is a potential playoff preview.
Well, they're 7-7. So
I've heard
it could
if they stay where they are, though, right now, that the Seals would host Panther City.
Yeah, which
right now in the playoffs in the first round, which is
at home. If we win tonight,
one and done.
If we win tonight, we have secured a home playoff game, which is awesome. And yeah, obviously, we want to play at home in front of the home fans, who have been really great this year. So I'm excited about it. It's gonna be tough to top last week or the last time we played, the walk off, down 5-1 to start. But if you haven't been to a Seals game, get your tickets at SealsLax.com. It's such a fun night, and I'm so ready to go out there and let up a lot of pent up frustration as I usually have. And hopefully we take it to him. Brody Merrill's first home game back, so that'll be excellent.
Hopefully there's not too much frustration from the Padres season yet. Let's check traffic, then we'll come back. One more look at today's game, series opener against the Giants, next here on 97.3 The Fan.
From the 97.3 The Fan Traffic Center, here's Kelly Danick.
Still a couple of problems here. Vehicle fire on southbound side of the 5 right before La Jolla Village Drive. It's over to the right shoulder. Also, south 5 near the border, just past Camino de la Plaza. There is a collision being cleared out of the fast lane. I'm Kelly Danick with Ben and Woods, San Diego's number one sports station, 97.3 The Fan.
So as we mentioned with Mike Shildt, same pitching matchup as Saturday night's game at Petco Park this afternoon. Dylan Cease for the Padres, Jordan Hicks for the Giants. And Hicks was really good in that start. He went 5 innings. Did not allow a run to the Padres. Cease went 4 2/3 innings, gave up 3 runs, 2 of them earned. So the Padres will be looking to kind of flip that around. Now, that was the game that the Giants scored 6 off Cosgrove in the 8th, and then they scored 5 with the 2 home runs in the 9th inning to kind of make it a little bit closer, but ended up losing 9-6 in that game.
Yep.
But it's the starting pitching that is kind of where you want to flip the script a little bit in today's game against the Giants.
And, yeah, I'm excited to see what Cease can do. I'm excited for first ups, too. I am. I'm excited for first ups. You know, I like hitting first. I like being on the road. I like being able to set the
tone. You trying to catch up with me in one fell swoop?
Oh, God,
here?
Did I? I didn't even realize.
I was like, what, are you doing a bit here?
I like sandwiches. I like the Seals. I like my wallet. I'm looking at all the things.
They had the first ups in the second game in Korea, but that's the only time that they've technically been the road team so
far
this
season.
I don't
even remember that.
Get out there and set the tone and quiet that crowd. I love hitting first. I do. I love. That's going to be my thing. I love hitting first. I love hitting first. I love setting the tone. Today's a good day, though. I mean, I'm not super mad about a 135 start. So I'll get to see most of the Padres game before I got to get dressed head on down to Pechanga for. I'd love a Padres win and a Seals win. It would be a perfect, perfect day. And then, of course, the Tier 1 baseball team returns on Sunday, weather permitting, 1 p.m. at Escondido High. And we're trying to even our record at 500.
I would imagine that Jackson Merrill will be back kind of the... Mike didn't give us the entire lineup.
Righties you're going to be seeing in San Francisco. Yeah. You're going to miss Snell. You're going to miss Harrison, thank God, for both of those. But you do. You got Logan Webb. And, of course, you got Jordan Hicks today. And both are pretty tough righties. So, yeah, they're going to have the work cut out for them, as usual. And I'm interested to see this weekend, too, if anything else happens on that Miami Marlins-San Diego Padres trade front.
Yeah, just because they wrote about it in The Athletic doesn't necessarily mean there's any current discussions. But we have seen when rumors come out in the past, like when the Dylan Cease rumors popped up in spring training, it was one day later. And the Padres weren't even the center of those rumors. And one day later, Dylan Cease was on his way to San Diego.
Got a lineup, Benjamin.
We do have
somewhere. Somebody are there telling me. Here we go. I got it. You ready?
Yeah.
All right. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Yeah, same six. Actually, 1, 2, 3. Four. Yeah, you got Bogarts, Tatis, Crony, Machado, Kim, Profar, Campy, Graham Pauly getting a start at third base today. Jackson Merrill in center field. Dylan Cease doing the pitching.
There has been no... No one's done a bad job. Everyone's had their moments. Wade, Pauly, Eggy struggled a little bit the last couple of times
bomb,
he's got
out
there, but he did have the home run. No one's really separated themselves.
Correct.
So it does feel like, well, I mean, I'm going to give you all chances to go out there and get hot, and if they do, I have no doubt that Mike Shildt will ride the hot hand. He kind of rode Tyler Wade for a few games early, and then he gave Pauly a chance. He hit the home run. He got a chance to start again, but then didn't do anything, so they went back to Wade. Eggy usually faces lefties, but don't have a lot of them so far, so he hasn't really had an opportunity to totally get going. But it seems like now it's another Pauly opportunity here. Show something, do something, and keep yourself in the lineup for the time being. But that's been the one spot that's been kind of, I could be anyone in that game. Everything else has been really consistent. Top six. Campy's your regular catcher. Day game after a night game, it'll be Higashioka. And then Merrill will be in center, except so far against lefties when Sugar has played in those games. And it's been an incredibly consistent lineup plan for Mike Shildt so far.
Well, and the funny thing is, and I see that's what people are getting most upset about online. Hey, let's go the hot hand with this guy, or let the kids play. The bottom of the lineup this year has been pretty good.
I like continuity.
Yeah, he likes continuity. The bottom, Ben, has been pretty good. I mean, they've helped in all of our wins. I feel like they've contributed a ton. So that's not Manny. I'd like to see him bust out this weekend in San Francisco, certainly. But you know, and Toddy, I want to see him stay
Manny,
hot.
Manny has not looked totally Manny-like yet, but. As Shildt pointed out, we're so early in the season. If he has a 3-for-4 game with 2 home runs, he's now among the league leaders in like homers, runs batted in. He's still one game away from putting up really good numbers. It's just doesn't look like he's seen the ball that well the last couple of games.
Yep, and it happens.
And we'll see. I mean, Mike Shildt said, don't make too much of this.
I won't.
But he did tell us. Manny a little ahead of schedule. I mean,
but he also said 2 weeks.
The timeline was end of April, though. And 2 weeks would be a full, like, 10 days ahead of the end of April, at least. So, you know, it's possible we could see Manny Machado back at third base maybe, you know, last week of April sometime. And that also increases the pressure on A.J. Preller.
Yeah.
Because I do feel like...
It's dumping
outside. Oh, yeah, wow.
I did not even... It was sunny.
It was sunny 10
minutes ago. The last time I looked outside...
I've heard hail. There's snow in our mountains right now.
It's coming down sideways.
It is not a fun Friday to be outside in San Diego in America's finest city. I do feel like there's a timeline on A.J. Preller, though. Once Manny is back in the field, you need a DH.
Yeah.
If you're just rolling out Pauly and Wade and Eggy, you're giving up something that you don't have to be giving up. So until then, it's okay because you need someone to play third base, and you don't necessarily want to acquire a third baseman because you've got Manny. So until Manny is back at third, you've got a bit of wiggle room. But once Manny's back, the Padres need a designated hitter. That's Hale, isn't it? I can hear that. Sounds like it's bouncing off our building.
Oh, wow. And you're right, Benny, for sure. But you also, I mean, if the Marlins, who haven't won a game yet, all of a sudden are like, everybody's on the block, you're going to have a lot more suitors. I mean, there's a lot of teams out there that could do really well with a Luis Arraez. So, I mean, again, when an article like that comes out, you know, you're like, oh, okay. I mean, this is now letting everybody know. Not that they didn't know that the Marlins are going to be probably open for business. But, you know, you also have to present the best offer, and it has to be timely. But we are in need. You know, we are desperately in need of somebody. And I do wonder if the Arraez deal doesn't work, if they do pivot to a Belt or somebody like that. Because you're right, man. They got about, if it's 2 weeks, let's just say 2 weeks, Manny's back at third and feeling 100%. Tyler Wade's DH. Eggy Rosario's your DH.
That doesn't work for me either.
And I'm sure it doesn't work for them. And I'm sure that's why there's rumors of trades and stuff going down. So,
are you mad that you didn't play? Maybe you did, but I feel like because of Skip, you didn't. A season-long under win total for the Miami Marlins.
I would never bet against Skip Schumacher.
There were some signs on the wall that this was not going to be a great year.
I mean, you lose four out of your five starting pitchers, it's not going to go well for you.
The writing was on the wall.
Yeah.
Now I don't think you could get a very good number at this point after an 0-8 start.
Nope.
All right, I see Annie and Elston are standing by after a good roundtable yesterday. But before we go, let's hear some things that Ben likes to end our week.
I like a lot of things.
I like Chick-fil-A sauce.
I just like rankings.
I like Steve Winwood.
I like Pie Gal Poker.
I like to be informed on subjects.
I like Chicago.
I like Tom Petty.
I like the idea of another left-handed bat in the lineup for sure.
I do like a good Matt Damon film.
I like being on the same page. I like broccoli. I like Brussels sprouts. I like a lot of things. I like this shirt.
I like Wipeout.
I liked my omelet.
I like San Diego State at home.
I like when a baseball player can be more than just a baseball player.
I like vanilla.
I like the atmosphere.
I like the felt on a poker table, just kind of how it feels under your fingers when you're there.
I like rhubarb pie.
I like the window seat.
Changing the subject, I like that.
I like just a standard yellow peep.
I like how San Diego State's playing right now.
I like finer things.
I like calling a game.
I like fiction more than nonfiction.
Just like the cream.
I actually like playing golf with other people.
I've liked everything I've seen so far from Mike Shildt.
I like Mexican food.
I like just the solar system.
I do like steak.
I like specifics.
I like going to 7 Mile Casino during the day.
I like that people are there having a good time.
I like my new eating schedule. I liked what I was eating.
Yeah. I like the variety of the menu at Sammy's. Mm-hmm.
I do like a good midnight buffet.
That's incredible.
That's round three of the things Ben likes. And I'm sure Polly is already well underway for round four.
We're going to need a new computer at some point.
Terabyte, some sort of room filled with servers just to store all the things Ben likes at some point.
On our last show ever, I just want to play an hour of it and walk out the door. That's all I want to do. I mean, that's like our final sign-off for you guys. I like you all. Big plans this weekend? Golf? I don't know. It's pretty nasty.
Certainly none today. I can tell you that.
I think my wife and kids are at Legoland right now. So that's... I was looking forward to having the whole house to myself. Something tells
inside the evacuation shelter at Legoland.
Something tells me they're going to be walking in the door as I'm pulling in the driveway. Sorry, it was raining. Oh, boy. Spring break over this week, though. This is the last day of spring
break. I am supposed to play tomorrow morning. I have to work tonight and tomorrow night at Channel 10.
This poor guy.
Other people with kids on spring break this week means Ben has to fill in. But I do have Sunday off. I'm looking forward to a relaxing Sunday. Just nothing planned at the moment.
I'm so sorry.
Lazy Sunday day. The lazy Sunday's great.
My man's driving into work tonight. I mean, I'm going to work tonight.
Sorry, yeah.
Seals, but it feels different.
I at least don't have to fight any traffic to get into the arena. You get there early enough that you don't either well. So,
come on out, sealslax.com.
All right, that is it for today's show. That's it for this week's show. We'll be back Monday morning at 6 a.m. We'll have three, hopefully, Padres games to talk about from San Francisco and an NCAA championship game. Annie and Elston next for Paul Reindl and Stephen Woods. I'm Ben Higgins. Have a great weekend from all of us here at 97.3 The Fan. So long, everybody.